Hi, everyone, and welcome to In Deep Geek Live. This is back to one of the usual live streams where I'm picking a topic in the world of A Song of Ice and Fire and open to questions across the piece. As always, I'm going to be shaping this around questions that I get from my patrons. And I think what I often do is sort of give a bit of a summary of the topic first, but I think this time we've got a bit of a handle on what the North is, what's going on there already. So I think what we'll do is we'll just go straight into a few questions. The only things that I want to do first of all is to say a big thank you to my moderators. You do fantastic work. I can see in the chat Chrissy Voldstones, Kraken Tacos, and Andrew Kay are all there, and joined today by Carl Karsnok. Thank you so much, Carl. In advance for excellent work. So the North, I was about to go into a big introduction, and after just saying I wasn't going to do one. I will also, however, thank Ryan Larkin. Thank you so much for the super sticker just before we went live. Josiah M as well. Thank you so much. And Eric Harker saying hello from Minnesota, the land of ice and snow and all the rest of it, which is apparently something I say a lot. Wonderful, and this you get to hear what you say, your little habits as you're speaking, which is great. We've all got little phrases we say a lot, and all the rest of it is apparently one of mine. Do you think it's possible that John executes Stannis for burning Shireen? Your content is always amazing. Hail Sithis. That's a Skyrim reference for those who don't know. I've been playing Skyrim, which is a fantastic video game. Will John execute Stannis for burning Shireen? I mean, I'm not going to say no, but I think that probably the balance of power at that point in time is going to be slightly different. I think that Stannis, while Stannis is around, he is claiming to be the king of the Seven Kingdoms, and Jon, when he returns, although he will probably return and claim to have left the Night's Watch or whatever, even if he is made Lord of Winterfell, I don't think that the balance of power is going to be so great, a change is going to be so great that Jon will feel that he can execute Stannis. So my best guess is probably not. I think that the burning of Shireen will definitely happen. George R. R. Martin has told us this. I think it will happen at the Wall, though. That is where Melisandre is. That's where Shireen is. So I think that will happen there. I think Stannis will in some way have had to give an instruction. But I think that the people that do it are, and the person who's going to get the blame will be Melisandre. So I think that something along the lines of, not exactly the same, but the spirit of what happened on the show, which is that Melisandre gets the blame for the burning and she gets sent off and then returns later in the day. I think that's probably the most likely. My best guess is that Stannis probably won't make it that far. He's not in a great situation at the moment, losing troops to the cold and all the rest of it. We'll come on to that very shortly, but I don't think he's going to make it to the end of the Winds of Winter. I may be wrong, but I don't think that that's likely. Josiah M, incidentally, I didn't see a question attached to your super chat. If you had one, please just drop it into the chat and I will get one of the moderators to pick up on it. Thank you very much. Mara Lee also, thank you so much for the super chat, saying just a show of immense love and appreciation for all the content, stories and fabulous merch. Thank you, Robert. Love to Dan, your gorgeous greyhound. Yep, Dan is, as usual, taking himself off to bed. So one day I'm sure he will be here and you'll be able to get a look at him live. Let's pick up some questions from my patrons then. Let's start with the situation at the moment in the North, because it's quite complicated, but I've had a few questions from different angles, but it's what's going on really behind the scenes with all the different houses. Is there a Grand Northern Conspiracy? What's likely to be happening over the course of the first few chapters of The Winds of Winter? So I will do a little preamble on this before answering the questions. The situation for those who are unaware or just need a little reminder, the Boltons are in Winterfell. They are holding Winterfell as it stands, and they've got their supporters in there with them. Now, Winterfell is not a happy place. There's a lot going on in there. The Freys are up there, very supportive of the Boltons. Also, we have the Manderleys who've come up and brought their army there, and some of the Umbers. We get the Barbary Dustin has arrived in there. We've got Mance Rayder who's arrived, who has gone undercover as someone called Abel the Bard. A lot is happening. It's not happy. There's a whole series of murders going on. And there's a lot of tension, as you'd expect, between the Freys and the Manderleys. It's very clear that Mance's mission, one of his missions at least, is to get Theon and the person that everyone thinks is Arya Stark out. They succeed in that. So in the pre-release chapter, the Theon pre-release chapter from The Winds of Winter, Theon and fake Arya, Jane Poole, have now escaped. The fighting, the infighting in Winterfell has led Roose Bolton to chuck out two armies. He sent out the Freys and the Manderleys to go and get Stannis, whose army is camped a few days away in a crofter's village. The thought is that Stannis will come to attack at some point, but he's sort of dug in a little bit. So it's all a little bit complicated. There's lots of plotting going on. Nobody's really sure who's on which side. So what I'll do is I'll work through these questions, and hopefully that will help us sort of work out what is going on across the piece. Samuel Leask says, "Hey Robert, best wishes from sunny Australia. I've recently been enjoying listening to your videos while I do the dusting at home. I do love hearing what people do while they're listening to this. What do you see Wyman Manderley's role being in The Winds of Winter? I see him being the main supporter behind Rickon and leading the Stark loyalists' revolt against Bolton rule. And after that, probably rallying behind Jon when he takes Winterfell." Yeah, I think you've got that broadly right, actually, I have to say. So the big bit of the jigsaw that I didn't speak about a moment ago was what Wyman Manderley has been doing. Now, he has been playing nice with the Boltons, and this is largely because his brother has been he needed to make sure that he was returned safely to White Harbor. But the way that he did this to try and gain everyone's trust was when Davos came seeking help, then he pretended to kill him. Davos being obviously Stannis's right-hand man, and so he pretended to kill him. This he thought would gain everyone's trust. It does seem to. However, this was all a big ruse, and instead he sends Davos off to try and get Rickon. Rickon, he has heard, is on Skagos. Now, he says if Davos gets Rickon and brings him back, then he will fall in behind Stannis's claim to be the king of the Seven Kingdoms. So the timing isn't 100% clear in the way that it's written, because George R. R. Martin, although he says now everybody's going to be on the same timeline as the last couple of books, then things haven't always appeared at exactly the same time. But it appears that that all happened a little while ago. A few months ago, in fact. And Davos has had time to go up to Skagos, do whatever he was going to do, and then come back again. In any event, Wyman Manderley has now headed off up to Winterfell, pretending to be loyal to the Boltons. Now, why might he have done that? The assumption has to be that he is at least thinking that he's going to get Rickon. And when he gets Rickon, he is wanting to rally the North behind Rickon Stark. Now, this is really important in that the opposition to the Boltons, it's the same anywhere. Opposition needs some sort of focal point. If you're going to depose someone, you need to have someone else to put in their place. So if you're going to get rid of the Boltons, you have to have someone back in their place. And as it stands, when people looked around in the north, there were no Starks. Because Arya, everyone thought, had been married into the Boltons already. Sansa has disappeared, but she had been married into the Lannisters, so nobody really trusted her. Jon wasn't really a Stark anyway, and he'd gone to the Wall and a couple of times refused to abandon it. Bran and Rickon, people think, are dead, so there are no Starks left for people to rally behind, and this was the big problem. And so Wyman Manderly, having spied the opportunity of getting somebody that people could rally behind, is now trying to get the North behind his candidate to take over. So that's the cunning plan. So when you're saying you see him being the main supporter behind Rickon and leading the Stark loyalist revolt against Bolton rule, and after that probably rallying behind Jon when he takes Winterfell, I think that's right. I think I'm definitely not alone in saying Rickon is not long for this plot. Now, George R. R. Martin did intriguingly say in, was quoted in a recent book, Fire Cannot Kill a Dragon, was that Rickon, had he argued strongly for Rickon to be included in the TV show, because Rickon had a big role to play. Now, that left a lot of us scratching our heads, because what role has Rickon got to play? But it's this. He is going to be the figurehead for the retaking of Winterfell. He is going to be the Stark figurehead. Now, when he dies, then, you know, there's probably going to be lots of other candidates suddenly appearing out of the woodwork, and we'll talk about them in a moment. But this is his important role, is being the Stark figurehead, which obviously will make him an immediate target for the Boltons. David Wisley here. Thank you. So thank you for the super chat and the question, saying Canadian YouTuber here, totally different genre. Can't wait for you to catch up to 200k. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm on 191, something like that at the moment. So hopefully at some point soon I will get there. Listen to many live streams while packing up my house, which I just sold. I enjoy your content tremendously. Well, thank you very much, David. I hugely appreciate support from other YouTubers, and I will check out your channel, and perhaps one of the moderators could put a link in there as well. Thank you very much. And also Carlito King, thank you, saying, will the Riverlands accept John as their king, even though he is not related to the Tullys? Or does Rob's will just name him heir to the North and not to the Riverlands? Okay, so let's start with Rob's will, because this is adding another part into this equation of what's going on in the North. Rob, towards the end of his life, suddenly became aware of the thing that I was, well, he didn't suddenly become aware of it. He had for a while been aware of the fact that, as far as he was concerned, his two younger brothers were dead. Arya had gone missing, and Sansa had just been married into House Lannister and therefore could not be trusted by the North. So he was the last hope for the Starks. But until he had children, he needed an heir. So there's a conversation he has with his mother, with Kat, and he basically says, I need to write a will. She's always politically canny and is basically saying this. And it's implied strongly, we never see the wording, so we can't be 100% sure, but it's implied strongly that he wrote into his will that he was legitimizing John, and John was the heir after him to Winterfell. So suddenly, when that will, which was then taken off by, I think it was by Mage Mormont, when that will surfaces, that creates another person in the mix who might have a claim to Winterfell. We've already got Rickon, who large parts of the north, including the Manderleys, who, let's not forget, are the richest family there in the north, certainly with House Stark on its knees, the strongest family in the north, behind Rickon. Suddenly we will have John, who will have a whole load of people perhaps rallying to his cause. Now, the reason why it's important that we didn't see what it was said on there is because I had a pre-recorded chat a while ago with Learned Hands Podcast, who are professional lawyers, and they've got a fantastic podcast. I'd highly recommend you check it out, looking at law in Westeros. And we talked through this, and the wording of the will, it could vary hugely. Does he legitimize John and say that he is the heir? Does he say that he is King of the North if Rob dies? Does he say, given the fact that my two younger brothers are both dead, John would be next in line? These things completely change what role John has, because if Rickon or Bran suddenly appear not dead, Rob has written his will with false information. So people could argue that perhaps he shouldn't have legitimized John, given the fact that he only did it thinking that his younger brothers were dead. There are lots of layers of complexity behind this, and as always, this will come down to a matter of who, not just who has the best claim, but who do people rally behind. And they may well rally behind John. So that's the sort of the next part of this jigsaw. Carlito, you were saying, you're asking about whether the Riverlands will accept John as their king, even though he's not related to the Tullys. And will Robb's will just name him heir to the North and not the Riverlands? Well, we don't, as I say, we don't know the exact wording. Probably wouldn't name him the Lord of the Riverlands, no. Because that's Rob himself does not claim the Riverlands. Now, would the Riverlands accept John? I think as we move towards the end game, more towards A Dream of Spring, when you start getting this idea that John might be the king, the rightful king of the Seven Kingdoms, then you get this issue of a sort of a power play of who forms up behind who. And the Riverlands will almost certainly go wherever House Stark takes them, because Sansa by this point is probably going to be in Winterfell. And I think that you will see the block emerge that has been there for a little while, actually, of the North and the Vale and the Riverlands, of that sort of like clump of northern parts of the Seven Kingdoms. They will have a lot more in common than the southern parts. Question from Karen Thomas, saying, Happy New Year, Robert, and everyone. Happy to see you back. We'll catch up with subtitles tomorrow. Oh, well, thank you very much. No question there, Karen, but Happy New Year to you as well. It's great to see you. Yes, if you do need subtitles, they can't often, with YouTube, do them live. And I know sometimes they can, but if you wait 24 hours, then the auto subtitles have caught up. So, yes, if you need them, then they are there a bit later. Bruce Branch, thank you so much for the super chat. Again, I don't see a question there, but if there is one, can you let one of the moderators know, and we will I will try and pick up on that. Okay, so question from Shannon Adams, still thinking about this northern conspiracy, saying, I'm a total fan of the Grand Northern Conspiracy. I would love for you to outline the major parties involved, as well as their motivations, goals, and methods. Do you think this conspiracy will coordinate with Stannis, Davos, Mance, and or Melisandre to a greater or lesser degree in the Winds of Winter? Okay, so we have got the Manderleys, who are at the heart of this, and House Glover, who are also on side. Now, House Glover, if you remember, so their home is Deepwood Mott. That was taken by the Ironborn, and then Stannis has retaken it. So they have got a reason to like Stannis. And they are with the Manderleys in this. So they have got this same goal of bringing the Starks back and supporting Stannis to be the king of the Seven Kingdoms. The Mormonts are, as we saw that wonderful line, the House Mormont knows only one Lord Starks, the one king, the Starks. So they, the Mormonts are loyal to House Stark. The others are slightly more complicated. That House Umber is split effectively at the moment because the Great John Umber is captured by the Boltons. So some of them have sort of grudgingly come over to the side of the Boltons. Whether they are really on his side, probably not. Some, however, are definitely not and have stayed outside and are undertaking a sort of a guerrilla warfare outside Winterfell at the moment. So that's there, a slightly more complicated situation. Then you get a few other houses you have come into Winterfell, like Barbary Dustin. So House Dustin is represented. They are, on the face of it, supportive of the Boltons, but she is clearly playing a very clever game. I've got a question about her a little bit later. So the big issue here is communication more than anything else. If the word gets out that there is a Stark who can be placed back into Winterfell, I personally think that the majority of the North will actually come back in. So the Karstarks seem to be the biggest sort of house that is unlikely to sort of fall in. There's been a little bit of a plot that they've been involved in that Stannis has uncovered. So in that pre-release chapter from the Winds of Winter, so you've got the Boltons, you've got the Freys, who are obviously not a northern house, but are deeply involved in there. You've got some of House Umber, you've got the Karstarks, you've got a few other possibles who are there. And then you've got some big houses who are pretending to support them and clearly aren't. So all this is a matter of coordination. And if Wyman Madley can coordinate this attack at some point, or not so much an attack, but a turning on the Boltons, then the coup, reverse coup, bringing the Starks back in, can go forward. And I think that is what is going to happen. But it will get more complicated because I think Rickon will die, will be killed, probably by Ramsay. Because Ramsay, throwaway comment, his hounds, we know that his hounds and the direwolves will at some point come into conflict. And as a throwaway comment, we hear that Ramsay's hounds have been trained to hunt humans and wolves. So I think that they will probably go out, hunt down Rickon, and kill Rickon. Which then obviously leaves a power vacuum, because having launched this great conspiracy with the aim of getting Rickon onto the throne, and then having probably at some point soon after that discovered that the Arya, who they thought, the person they thought was Arya, actually isn't Arya, suddenly there's this huge power vacuum. And what we've got then is that's the point at which we might suddenly find that Jon returns from the dead and perhaps gets this will, which legitimizes him, and he starts getting people gathering around behind him. But also Littlefinger, I suspect, will suddenly smell an opportunity. There are no Starks left. He has got a Stark. He, I think, and this is how I think Sansa's going to get into the North, is he is going to bring her up to the North, thinking that he can place her into Winterfell and then control both the North and the Vale, because that's how Littlefinger works. He sees chaos and he sees, tries to see the opportunities within it. So suddenly you're going to have a few different Stark claimants going on. Now, whether they will be against each other, it's probably more likely that their followers will be against each other, it has to be said. And talking about Stephen Dillon saying, do you think that there will be a mini civil war in the North? Jon Sansa and Rickon all seem to have their own supporters, and I don't see some like Littlefinger backing down so easily. Yeah, I think so. I don't think there's going to be a civil war, but there will definitely be a lot of disagreement. And what will be required to pull everyone together is the threat from the others. So that's where all of that is, I think. Oh, Bruce Branch, thank you so much, saying, I listen while driving my big rig at night throughout New York State. Appreciate you, my guy. Well, thank you so much. Nobody's been driving big rigs so far. So thank you for that. Evan Power, thank you, saying, hola, Robert, hola. In Fire and Blood, Torrhen Stark's crown was taken with the Northern Swords and maybe in the Iron Throne. Does this have any symbolic meaning? The Iron Throne clearly in and of itself has got symbolic meaning, because it is the melted down swords of the armies that were defeated by the Targaryens. Now, does this have a particular symbolism for the North? No, I don't personally think so. I think that there are no, various people have suggested that there might be, but as far as we're aware, there are no particularly symbolic swords within the Iron Throne. There's nothing in there that you could sort of pull out and like reclaim it. So Ice, the family sword for the Starks, wasn't there. That wasn't handed over. There was nothing going on. So I think not, other than the greater symbolism for the Seven Kingdoms as a whole. Question from Mr. E. Knight, thank you, saying, the Riverlands being much more populated by both human and animal prey, I understand Nymeria and her pack sticking around, but when do they go north? So Nymeria, since Arya drove her off, Nymeria has been staying in the Riverlands, building up a super pack of wolves. And George R. R. Martin has specifically said that this is a Chekhov's gun, Chekhov's super pack. You do not keep on mentioning a super pack of wolves unless you are going to use them for something. So what are they going to be used for? Well, in the Riverlands, there's a lot going on. And what they seem to have been doing is, well, first of all, Nymeria, let's not forget, was the one who pulled Catelyn Stark from the river, which allowed her to then become Lady Stoneheart. And also they've been attacking some Freys. So I think what we're going to see is that the Nymeria's wolf pack will get involved in what through the course of the Winds of Winter is likely to be this very complicated pushing out of the Lannisters and regaining of control for House Stark and sort of House Tully within the Riverlands. So they will play a role. They're not just a random super pack. Arya, on a near nightly basis, as far as we can tell, wargs into Nymeria. And so Nymeria is acting in the Starks' best interests and with Arya's vengeful spirit. So I have a suspicion that they will be involved in what the vengeance on House Frey, because they are there in the Riverlands. The Walder Frey is actually on in the books, he's not, you know, none of the people involved in that are actually on Arya's list. So when in on the show she came and killed this whole long list of people, that's not actually where we're expecting her to be going in the books. That doesn't mean that she doesn't want to have revenge on this long list of Freys. Of course she does, but I think it's more likely to be done with the wolves. When will they go north? I think once the work in the Riverlands is done is my short answer, which is probably towards the end or of the Winter or at the beginning of A Dream of Spring. Question from Audrey Rager. Thank you so much. Saying, can you discuss the ghost in Winterfell? The women with Mance didn't do all the killing. The cloaked figure, who is he? Okay, so the ghost in Winterfell is the name of a chapter of a book. And so the boring literary answer is that the ghost in Winterfell is Theon, because the way that George R. R. Martin, all of his chapter titles is the name of the person from whose perspective we are reading that chapter, and we read this through Theon's eyes, and therefore the ghost in Winterfell is a description of him. Now, what George R. R. Martin tends to do is, with some characters, he just sticks to their first name, but then he's trying to show us something about a character by using either a different name or a descriptor of them. So what this is, from a pure literary perspective, before we move on to the other elements, from a pure literary perspective, what George R. R. Martin is trying to show us is that at this point, Theon is, he's just like a shadow of his former self. He's like a ghost. He's not really there. Who he once was, he's not access to. He's just sort of wandering around aimlessly, and he does in this chapter wander around aimlessly. And fantastically, the next chapter he is called Theon, so he sort of regains a little bit of his spirit and soul, and this is a start of a journey back towards being him. I hope one only true, and I say I hope, but probably the only one true redemption arc we get in Song of Ice and Fire. Now, that to one side. The next level to this is the fact that Theon himself, as he's wandering around Winterfell, he even thinks to himself that there are lots of ghosts. This place is filled with ghosts, he says to himself. He thinks he sees and hears voices from the past and all the rest of it. And that is what is happening at a sort of a slightly more meta level as we're seeing things through his eyes. Then, however, there are some murders going on. Now, I've kind of hinted at this already. Now, the murders are of strategic people, which seem to be not necessarily, when I say strategic, not necessarily important people, but people that when they are killed will start to build up tensions within Winterfell. These are targeted in order to try and build up some kind of build up towards some fractures in the defenses of Winterfell. So this is an inside job. And most of these murders seem to have been done by Mance and his spear wives. This makes perfect sense because they have been brought down from the wall. They've been sent down basically as an advance party, knowing that Stannis at some point is going to attack. So to be sowing the seeds of division makes absolute perfect sense. However, there is the last one. Then they deliberately actually say, no, that one wasn't us, to Theon. So there is another murder. Who does this? Well, we get this character called the Hooded Man. I think I'm going to do a video on the Hooded Man because I get asked this a lot, and I have a few ideas, but the fact is that this is literally about four or five lines of text in the books. So I think we focus in on it a lot because it's a huge mystery. Theon meets a hooded man. And the implication, the clear implication, is that this hooded man knows who he is. He calls him Theon. He reaches his hand. His instinct is to reach his hand to kill Theon. But then basically Theon says, don't worry, you know, Ramsay's already going to kill me. And then the other guy goes, okay, well, I'll leave you to him then. And then heads off. And that's it. Now, this is a mystery because Theon, although he seems to recognize this person, very, very soon after this is when he starts musing about this place is full of ghosts. The clear implication is that this is somebody who he knew from a long time ago. Now, my best guess is that this is a guy called, I always mispronounce his name, Hollis Mollen, I think. Now, he is somebody who was a part of the Stark retinue when it went down south. And he is the person who was given Ned Stark's bones by Catelyn Stark. So if he is back in Winterfell, that probably means that Ned Stark's bones are back in Winterfell, which makes some sense because we've been reminded about his bones just a few chapters earlier when we get Barbary Dustin who's talking about them. So that all kind of ties in. My best guess is that he is not the murderer. However, this last one probably... I mean, I will... Again, as I say, I'll do a video on it, but my best guess is this is probably the Manderlys pushing things along. But thank you. Really interesting question. I think I had one more. Or is that it now? Oh, yeah, Jace. So thank you so much. Saying, rarely get to watch live, but I saw that you're on. Just sending a thank you, and we'll watch later. Well, thank you very much. And if this is your first time watching live, or if you don't often get to watch live, but you are today, then welcome. It's a very different experience watching live, taking part in the chat. So it's great that you could pop in, and thank you so much. And also, I think I just saw popping up a question from Reflective Rambling. Thank you so much. Saying, for Evan Hayes, this is something you do a lot, Reflective Rambling, and I hugely appreciate it when you pick up on questions. The chat goes through very quickly, and I don't always manage to pick up on everyone's questions. If they're in super chats, then they flash up in bright colours and I get to see them. So thank you so much for doing a super chat on behalf of Evan Hayes, saying, you, sir, must spend 5 years at one of the North's houses, not Winterfell. Which one would you choose and why? What if you had to do it 1,000 years before the events of A Song of Ice and Fire? Where would I spend 5 years in the North? Ooh. I mean, probably in White Harbour, to be honest. Most of the North is a very grim place. And in 5 years, you would probably have to survive a winter. Then that wouldn't be very pretty. So I think... If I can't be at Winterfell, then probably I would find myself at White Harbour, which seems quite a civilized place, all things considered, it has to be said. And they make some legendary dark beer there as well. So I think I would find myself very happy. 1,000 years ago, I don't think the answer would change hugely. I do think that I mean, Bear Island probably is the other place you would go. When you read about Bear Island, I mean, we know Bear Island vaguely because we know that it's a bit boring. That's where Jorah took his wife and then she got bored. But it's also beautiful. When you read about it, it's got mountains, it's got trees, pines, waterfalls. It sounds like this beautifully idyllic place to live. Yes, there's some bears roaming around. Yes, you might get the Ironborn Greyjoys attacking you or something like that. But I think it seems a fantastically beautiful place to be. So I think those would probably be my two top choices. Thank you. And questions from Ultraviolence saying, hi, Robert, on the topic of Northern mysteries, do you have any theories on who wrote the pink letter? I do, and I did a video on that. So if you want a longer explanation, then just have a search through my back catalogue. But the short version is that it's not, I think, pretty clearly not written by Ramsay. The style is, and some of the word use is very much from someone north of the wall. And the way what it's written about is, it's very, very focused on Mance Rayder, it has to be said. Mance Rayder, what happened to Mance Rayder, what happened to Mance Rayder's spear wives, what might be happening to Mance Rayder's baby, what might be happening to one of Mance Rayder's friends. There's huge amounts about Mance Rayder and only a little bit about what's going on with other things. So this seems to imply that he wrote it, given the fact that it's written to Jon Snow, with the intention to sort of incite him to attack Winterfell. Now, who wants Jon to be leaving the Night's Watch and attacking Winterfell? Does Mance Rayder want that? I mean, maybe, but that's not really a thing that's been driving him. The person who really wants that, who has been asking him to do that, is Stannis. Is it part of Stannis's character to be doing letters, pretending to be from someone else, underhand tactics? No, not at all. Does he even know that Mance Rayder is there? No, this was Melisandre's doing. So Melisandre sent Mance off. We know that it was her who sent him off. And she sent him off and said, one of the things you have to do is send this letter to get Jon to be leaving the wall and heading down to help Stannis, because that's what Melisandre wants. So that's my theory. There's more to it than that, but have a look at the video if you are interested. Kofi Amankwa, do you think Tormund Giantsbane is Lyanna Mormont's father? So this is a great theory, and I think it was Alt-Shift-X who did a video on this, which I would recommend you go and check out. There is more evidence of this than you might think, because at first it does sound a little bit like a couple of random characters, but he talks about sleeping with bears. Obviously, Bear Island and the House Mormont talk about themselves, have nicknames connected with bears, and you get Lyanna Mormont's mother. May well have slept with some raiders, some wildling raiders, or a wildling raider who came in. The wildlings, the Bear Island is very far north, and so the wildlings do come across there. So it's very possible. I think so, but I think it's probably going to be one of those things that we never actually find out the truth of it. But I like the idea, and it kind of suits it, doesn't it? Okay, let's go to question from Eric Fogg, still thinking about the Northern conspiracy here, saying, what do you think Wyman is up to? Well, the Manderly forces are presumably turning on the Freys. Is he going to die from his existing injuries? Is he going to attempt more sabotage or murder within Winterfell? So Wyman Manderly, we don't know exactly what's going on with him. The last we see, when there's this last murder in Winterfell, and the Manderlys and the Freys are at each other's throats, and Wyman Manderly, to be honest, he prompts this because he says, because there was a boy who was killed, and he says, how old was he? And then one of the Freys says that he was only whatever age, and Wyman Manderly says, that's a shame, although at least he won't have to grow up to be a Frey, which is obviously quite provocative. And then his reward for this is by having a Frey leaping at him, drawing a sword and slashing him across the throat. He is saved. He does not die, but clearly he took quite a bad wound. And he's a man, he's known as the Lord Manderly, too fat to ride a horse. He is not in the best of health. So he's probably going to stay there and just try and direct events from Winterfell. That's the most likely thing for him to be doing. We don't know yet. The story hasn't got any further. We haven't seen inside Winterfell since Theon has gone, so we don't know the details of what that is. But yes, I think that the clear idea here is that he is going to try and coordinate the insurrection within Winterfell, because once the Frey forces, who have now been sent out, once they're defeated, the next step is obviously for Stannis to come in and try and take Winterfell from the Boltons. And that would be a very hard job at the best of times. So, and with all of the snow and the bad weather, it's an even worse job. So, or worse chance of him succeeding. So they need people on the inside. And I think that's what he's going to be doing, is trying his best to basically open up the gates and let him in. A question from E. Knight, thank you, saying, for Michael W., thank you very much for picking up on something from someone else. What is your take on Jojen and Mira's oath? I swear it on earth and water. I swear it by bronze and iron. We swear it by ice and fire. So this is when Jojen and Mira come up to Winterfell to swear fealty to what the time was Robb Stark, actually, but Bran took the oath on his behalf. So they come up, they swear fealty, and they seem to have their own oath of fealty that they do, which was what I just read out. Now, what's important about that? Well, there is a couple of things that are quite interesting. The first is just before the oath, which is that they are introduced as the Lady Mira and her brother Jojen. Now, that very clearly implies that she is actually the one with greater precedence than him, which is intriguing. Because normally you'd expect the man to have precedence over the woman, with male preference primogeniture, which seems to imply something's been going on there in the neck that has changed the way they do things. I've got a whole other theory about that one. But in terms of this exact oath, this is clearly, I think, harking back to ancient times. The thing about the Crannogmen is that they, first of all, they hardly ever leave the neck, so we don't know huge amounts about them. But secondly, they are clearly very, very closely tied in with the Children of the Forest. Now, the fact that their oath of fealty to the Starks is by ice and by earth and water, bronze and iron, and ice and fire does seem to imply that this is something. Ice and fire is one of the few times that ice and fire is mentioned. This is something harking, I think, all the way back to the original pact between the First Men and the Children of the Forest. It may even be the pact, the words that were spoken there. So I think that that, because it is very different from what everyone else seems to be having as their oaths, and because the Crannogmen have got that ancient link, I think it's much more likely that this is from a very, very long time ago. Okay, question from Mara Lee, saying, will Robb Stark's will ever be found? If so, what do you think will happen as far as Jon Snow is concerned and his possible claim as King or Warden of the North? Will the Northern Lords honour Robb's will, or will it be disregarded since the Boltons right now are currently in charge? Will Lady Stoneheart play a role in helping find Robb's will and thereby helping to honour her late son's memory by honouring his last wishes? Now, my take on this is, so I think that the will resurface. It was, as I say, it was being taken up, and it was last seen to the north, last seen in the neck. And I think that it will emerge, and it will emerge during the Winds of Winter. It will be brought up to Winterfell, and it will be after we get Rickon's death. So after Rickon's death, suddenly, and John has returned from the dead, suddenly here he is legitimized. And so I think people will come in behind John as the Lord of Winterfell. And then Sansa, having come up with Littlefinger, is suddenly not going to be the person in line to take over Winterfell. So I think that's what's going to be happening there. So the Boltons will be out of the scene by the time that the will comes to light. I don't think Lady Stoneheart is going to play a role in this. So Lady Stoneheart is down in the Riverlands. The action in the north is months away for her. It would take a very long time for her to travel all the way up there. And right now, she is very focused on doing things in the Riverlands. So there's no hint that she's about to go north. So I think she is going to be staying down there for the foreseeable future. Now, as I say, the question with the will is, what does it actually say? And what does it make John? If it makes him King of the North, the final wrinkle in all of this before we sort of move on to other questions about the North, but thinking about the Northern Conspiracy, the final wrinkle here is that if it announces him as King of the North, what then does that mean for Stannis? Because Stannis wants Jon to be Lord of Winterfell, but he wants him to be Lord of Winterfell paying fealty to him as the King of the Seven Kingdoms. And if Jon is being called the King of the North, that is the name that you give to the North when it has seceded from the Union, so to speak, when it has left the Seven Kingdoms. And so if the Northern Lords decide that they wish to call Jon the King, then that, if Stannis is still around, that immediately places the North in confrontation with Stannis. So that is the final wrinkle, and that's the matter of when Stannis is going to go, is going to be very important. Big Kev 619 SD, does the North remember? What do they remember? So the North remembers is obviously a great catchphrase, and the question is, what do they remember? What they're supposed to remember is the history of the others, and what the defenses are for that, and the role of the Starks and all the rest of it. And that is what they're supposed to be remembering. Do they remember it in legend only, is basically where we're at now. So they do remember in theory, and they have got a lot of the defenses right in theory. So the watch, for example, the Night's Watch, have the they have a calling sign for if the others come, three toots on the horn. That is what, even though a lot of them don't think that the others exist, they still have the mechanisms and processes in place in order to be protecting themselves. They have the wall with the magical barrier. So the North doesn't remember, but it has all the things it needs to remember. So what is required is somebody who can remember for them. And that is going to be Bran. So Bran is going to be able to see back through time, and he will be able to remember for them. So does it remember? No, at the moment it doesn't, but it will, because it will be told or reminded. Cyclops is better than Wolverine, saying, how did House Manderly get so many bannermen? So House Manderly was... So they weren't originally a Northern House. They come down, they were originally, I think, in the Reach, possibly the Riverlands, but they were from south of the Neck. And there was a dispute, and they left. But the Starks said, you can have a home here, White Harbor. If you swear fealty to us, then you can have this place here. Now, what at the time, this was just a a small fortress at the mouth of a river. But what that turned into was the biggest, the only city in the north and the biggest trading port in the north and access to the north. So the King's Road was only built a couple of hundred years ago. And before that, yes, there was a pathway that went through the neck, but it was very hard to get through. And the main route in was through White Harbour on a boat. And because a lot of the rest of that side of the north is very rocky, really, there's only one way in. And the White Knife River heads up towards Winterfell. So this is the key strategic place. The Manderleys, they already had some wealth, but they grew their city. They had the port income. They had the income from people wanting to go into the north. And they got richer and richer and richer. And added to which, they also could look to the south as well as the north. They retained a lot of their southern identity. They still had knights. They still worshipped the Seven. They were fiercely loyal to the Starks, but they retained a broader outlook in a way that a lot of the North was very inward-looking. They could be outward-looking as well. And that meant that they could, because they remained fiercely loyal, because they remained incredibly rich, they could expand their influence and gain Bannermen along the way. So that was, that's the sort of the history of what was going on there with House Manderley. And the result is that they are hugely powerful now in the north. Aaron Pena saying, don't answer if you don't want to. Do you have a day job? If so, how do you find time to put out all this great content? Thanks for everything. Yeah, I don't tend to answer questions about personal life stuff. Thankfully now, though, I'm very happy to say this is what I do with most of my time now. So I can I've got lots of other responsibilities going on, but I can now, thanks to support from my patrons, I can now focus in on providing a lot of content here on this channel, as well as my second channel, The Well Told Tale, which gives me the opportunity to thank my patrons. I always look for an opportunity to do that. Patrons, thank you. As I said, I cannot do what I do without your support, and I'm hugely grateful. If you are interested in supporting the channel, if you want to get access to some of the stuff I do just for my patrons, then do check out my Patreon page. There's a link I was going to say down in the description. If you're watching this live, I don't think I put the description in this, but if you're watching later, there will be a link down in the description. So thank you very much. That I think is me caught up on the chat. Andrew Kane, I don't think I can focus. I think I could call this for too much. Question from Oyan Johnson. Okay, so we're moving on a little bit now from just thinking about the Great Northern Conspiracy to wider issues of the North. Saying, I was going to ask about the Hooded Man. Somebody already has. My favorite unanswered Northern question is about Ned Stark's mother. She is a Flint, but we know little to nothing beyond that. Ned doesn't recall her. Her grave is never mentioned. Her death is not recorded. We hear of what Rickard does. We don't hear much about what she does. This seems like quite an odd omission. So I'd love to get your take. Well, I'm very happy to do that. So Ned's mother, Rickard's wife, was called Lyara. Now, she wasn't, when you say she was a Flint, she was Lyara Stark. She was the daughter of Roderick Stark and Arya Flint. So it's Ned's grandmother who was the Flint. Now, House Flint are they're one of the houses in those mountains to the north of Winterfell, sort of on the west coast of the north, heading up towards the Wall. And they are not traditional houses as you might think. They're sort of mountain clans, but they do pay fealty in their own way to House Stark. So what we have is Lyanna Stark. So that meant that technically Ned's father married his first cousin, I think is the way that it is. But anyway, so Lyanna Stark, no, we don't hear much about her at all. The only assumption I can make is that she must have died when the children were very young, and that meant that they didn't really know her. So there's a is it a striking omission? I guess it is when you start to think about it, but actually for the Starks, they quite early on in the story they all split apart, and they're not actually thinking about their home and their own heritage. What's important with the Baratheon's heritage is obviously we have to learn about the link up to House Targaryen. The Targaryen's heritage is clearly very important because of the dragon riding and Valyrian link. House Lannister's is because understanding the way the characters of the three Stark, the three Lannister children, you have to understand the absence of Joanna Lannister, Tywin's wife. So there is a good reason for understanding about this, the missing mothers in various other parts of this world that George R. Martin has created. But the absence of Ned Stark's mother doesn't seem to have, this is the conclusion we have to reach, is that it doesn't have a narrative or character driven element to it. One can only assume that this may have played in at least partly. Yes, we know that Rickard Stark had Southron ambitions, but his willingness to send his children down to the south to be fostered by other people perhaps was also partly driven by the fact that he didn't have someone there to share their upbringing with. So perhaps he felt that they needed that kind of presence in some way. I don't know. We're not told. And I think the only conclusion we can draw from this is that it is not important to the character development of any of the Starks. One thing, however, I would just, as a complete aside, just when I was having a quick flick through this beforehand, a quick prepare, something I hadn't discovered for was before was Roderick Stark, Ned's grandfather, was known as the Wandering Wolf. Now, this was a character that I'd never really thought about before, but he was known as the Wandering Wolf, and he apparently did head off around the world. He went over to Essos. He joined the Second Sons for a while before obviously returning and marrying someone from House Flint, which in and of itself was probably a little bit out of the way for the Starks. So when we think about the Starks being, and the North in it being introverted and focused in on itself, then we mustn't think that that's always the case. There are always some people who do head off and do other things. And it's he's actually used as an example for Bran, as to, or in fact, she, the Flint part, because perhaps that's why he likes climbing so much, because the Flints have to climb mountains all the time. Anyway, slight aside, but I found that with the Wandering Wolf quite interesting. Question from Nemo Nova, saying, for Sebastian Miranda, thank you so much again for picking up for something else. Your thoughts on Hodor's, pardon me, your thoughts on Hodor's parentage. Thanks. Well, we are told it. I can't remember off the top of my head the exact parentage, but the interesting thing about him in terms of his ancestry, obviously, is where does he get this great height from? I fully subscribe to this idea that we've got some evidence for that he is a descendant of Sir Duncan the Tall from the time that Duncan Egg visited Winterfell. That makes sense to me. That fits in with the sort of the timelines that we have. We certainly see a very tall knight kissing a woman in the Godswood when Bran looks through the Weirwood tree and goes back through time at a roundabout, given we know that his visions are going back through time. The time period for that is around about the right sort of time for that to happen. So, and George R. R. Martin did say that we would see descendants of Duncan, as in more than one. And yes, we have Brienne, who definitely is a descendant of Sir Dunk, but I think Hodor probably is as well. Let's not forget that Hodor did not start being Hodor like that. He started off being a normal person who knew more than one word, but I think this is at least partly George R. R. Martin playing on this thing that if you read the Duncan Egg stories or listen to them, it gets repeated again and again. Dunk the Lunk, thick as a castle wall. Dunk thinks of himself as being very slow, always missing out on stuff. And this is perhaps, I think, George R. R. Martin placing a little bit of that into Hodor. This fact that somebody has an innocence to them that is quite pure. And I think that that is something which does work down to him. Question from Kendra Summers. Thank you so much. Very generous super chat. Thank you. Wanted to join your Patreon for a long time and finally got round to signing up. Just wanted to say your content is always enjoyable and your demeanor is positive, genuine, and you're a delight to listen to. Maybe a Duncan Egg live stream one day. Well, first of all, thank you. And thank you for joining the Patreon. You're very welcome. I think I saw a question from you as well, which I shall pick up when we get to it. And thank you for those very nice words. I try my very best to be positive and genuine as much as I possibly can. A Duncan Egg live stream. I have done a Duncan Egg live stream before, and I will definitely do one again. Do not worry. So I love the Duncan Egg stories, and I think that they are a wonderful counterpoint to what we have, the darkness of A Song of Ice and Fire, to have this slightly lighter, slightly more optimistic, slightly, I would say happier. There's a lot of bad stuff happens in those stories, but it's told through such a delightful voice. Dunk's perspective on life is so fantastic that it makes it a really enjoyable read. So yes, I'm a big fan, and I definitely will again at some point. But thank you so much. That's incredibly generous of you. Sonata Systems, thank you so much, and a very generous super chat from you as well. Thank you. Saying, and not dead yet. Good. I'm very pleased. Was there ever a pandemic in Westeros? Lots of so the summer sickness, there was actually thinking about Duncan Egg, that happened during their time. In fact, one of the reasons they headed off down into Dorne to escape it, because that was part of the only part of the Seven Kingdoms that didn't get this summer sickness. So yes, there have, and that killed lots of people, incidentally, a couple of Targaryens in line to the throne, not directly, but they were in ahead of Egg in line to the throne, and that swept across the entire continent. But there are lots of examples of things, if you go back through Fire and Blood and the World of Ice and Fire, lots of examples of city-specific things that happen. So you get the Grey Plague, which is like grayscale, but on a mass scale, sweating sickness and all kinds of things happen. In the Old Town, a few times going back through history, we hear of Old Town shutting its gates, keeping everybody in and letting it all die out, and half of the population dying. This happened in Pentos. This is Magister Illyrio, lost his wife in, then the Grey Plague happened over there. We hear of it in lots of different places. So yes, there are lots of different plagues and pandemics and sicknesses which do appear, and the fact that they haven't played a major role in the story of A Song of Ice and Fire thus far does make me think that they probably, that it probably will before the end, probably in King's Landing. I think that seems to be the most likely place for it. I've opined on this a few times before, that particularly with John Connington coming in, who's got grayscale, and port cities are always the most vulnerable to this kind of thing. Given that King's Landing is in many ways a sort of a reflection of London, one of the huge things way back 1665, there was the Great Plague in London, followed by the Great Fire. We think that there will be fire in King's Landing, and it makes sense if before that there could be some sort of plague. So yes, it's going to happen, I'm pretty sure. George R. R. Martin loves piling on the pain for us, doesn't he? Okay, so question from Stephen Dillon. Do you think that Alice Carstark was a red herring as the girl in grey? She was wearing black. There is a theory that it may be Sansa, like the show, with the mountain clans attacking during her tourney or wedding to Harry and fleeing to safety with Jon at the Wall. It kind of seems convoluted, but I wanted to see what you think. So the girl in grey, this was something that Melisandre saw in the flames. She decided this was Arya, told Jon. Then they get this rumor of this person who arrives. It's actually Alice Carstark who arrives, and everyone goes, oh, so that's who it was. It wasn't Arya after all. Yes, I think she was a red herring. The thing with Melisandre, as a rule of thumb, is that she sees the right thing. She's got the magic and the skills to see the right things, but she misinterprets it. That's a general rule of thumb with Melisandre all across the piece. So if she thinks that, what I think is probably quite likely is what we have in the pre-release, the Theon pre-release chapter from the Winds of Winter. And as I'm having to say every time now, George R. R. Martin has told us he is rewriting at least one of those pre-release chapters, so they aren't canon, but I, given the fact that that Theon chapter was originally planned to be in the previous book, he just sort of shunted it forward, and he did publish it a long time ago. I think that's probably the best bet for being the one, being something that survives relatively intact. But anyway, in that, Stannis sends fake Arya, Jane Poole, north to the Wall. He is intending this as this long campaign that he's got to try and get Jon Snow on his side, to try and get the northern houses on his side. He decides that he is going to, having got what he thinks is Arya Stark, he is going to return her to her half-brother, as he thinks, Jon Snow. So he sends her up north. So I think she is going to go and reach the Wall. And I think that she is going to be the person that Melisandre actually saw in her flames. Now, because I'm the kind of person who loves going down wormholes, I then went back to have a look in the last Theon chapter that we have, the official Theon chapter that we have, to see whether I could see what clothes she was wearing. And yes, sure enough, when she was rescued from Winterfell, they made her change clothes so that she looked like a washerwoman, and it was what was described as a grey smock, or might not smock, might not being the right word, but it was grey. And So assuming that she doesn't suddenly magically get a change of clothes, there is a very good chance that she will be a girl in grey heading up to the wall. So that's my general take on what's going on there. But as with all of these things, with sort of prophecy and visions, it can be interpreted in a number of different ways. And so, yes, Alistar Stark was an important person coming to the North, but also fake Arya is going to be an important person heading to the North. The purple feline, thank you, saying, while I'm listening to your videos, I often work on handcrafted cards or pamper myself with a manicure. Keep these coming, guys. I love hearing what you're doing. To my question, I was just wondering how the Starks came to be kings or wardens of the North. What set them apart from other groups or houses? Thank you for all the hard work you do. You're very, very welcome. So the history of the Starks is that way back when House Stark was founded, and it was, as far as we can tell, founded by Bran the Builder, who created Winterfell, and that was then, or at least he built Winterfell crypts with magical help from the children, and that established House Stark in a very important place in the North. It is relatively central, but the key thing is the hot springs. And the hot springs allow them, because in the North the winters are so horrific, the hot springs are what allow life to continue in Winterfell compared to almost everywhere else in the North. Now that gave them a competitive advantage against others. They also then, I think, originally probably had a lot of luster for being connected with the Children of the Forest and all the rest of it, which they were at the very beginning. But they still remained one of many, many petty kings in the North. Now, we think of the North as being just one whole area controlled by the Starks, but it's not always been like that. The Starks had to take on one after another lots of different petty kings, petty lords, and either defeat them or marry into them in order to get them to be paying fealty to the Starks. And that process took hundreds, thousands of years. The Starks slowly gaining ground and expanding until all of the North followed them. So what set them apart? Probably their founding, probably their competitive advantage of having Winterfell. Probably they did have some sort of magical ancestry in and of themselves. The fact that the direwolf is their symbol, and that the Stark kings statues have direwolves there, do seem to imply that there has been a link with the direwolves, which is not just with the Stark children we see in the story today, but extends way back into history. So I think that there clearly is some sort of magical thing there. And over time, they became very canny at building alliances. So we've already talked about what happened with the Manderleys, got an incredibly loyal ally there, which also then held control through the Manderleys. Then the Starks held control of access to the North up the White Knife River, which obviously helped them cement control. And then they went about a lot of marrying with other families. We've already talked about the Flints. We hear about Starks marrying Mormonts and lots of other Northern families. So clever use of political marriage and things like that. And also setting up like the Karstarks, cadet branch of the Starks, that kind of thing. So this is not just one particular strategy, but a long, long period. And there's also one of the other sayings that there must always be a Stark in Winterfell. I think that has a very specific reason for that to start with, the need for there to be Starks in Winterfell. But that created, I am sure, this mythos around it, that there must be a Stark in Winterfell is the kind of thing that just supports their claim to be the rightful rulers of the North. So that's not just one reason, lots of different reasons why I think that they prevailed in the longer term. To Aderi, just in the chat, saying, adding to those thoughts, with the warmth in Winterfell, they get to thrive during winter, leaving them stronger to attack and defend each spring. Absolutely, this is really quite important. So what a lot of the northern houses did when winter came, they just shut up shop, and a lot of their older people were just sent out into the snows to die effectively, and they just, the growth and size of and strength of that house was constrained by the size of their castle, basically, whereas in Winterfell it became the home for everyone from all around who could come into Wintertown and have the benefit of the warmth of the springs, and not just getting warmth from the springs, but that just allowed crops to grow. They got this wonderful sort of glass garden, where basically a huge greenhouse where they could grow crops through the winter. And as you said there, this did allow them in the spring to not have been damaged by the winter. Lots of people died in the winter, and the Starks would have survived it a lot more easily. Rachel van der Voort, I think this is my first time catching the live chat, so hello. Hello, and welcome. A question from the Greasy Strangler, saying, I've always been fascinated by the legend of Bael the Bard, who was a wildling king who climbed the wall and snuck into Winterfell. Can you tell us about him and what comparisons or likenesses you make with Mance Rayder? Okay, so Bael the Bard is a legendary character. I say legendary. We don't know how old this legend is. It's fascinating that a lot of the legends we're told, this is from the Age of Heroes or this is from wherever. But this, it's not 100% clear. We get a reference to the King's Road, which seems to imply maybe it was in the last 300 years or so, or a couple of hundred years or so, but that doesn't seem quite long ago enough. John and Ygritte have discussions about it and whether it actually happened, and it doesn't, Ygritte says it doesn't really matter whether it really happened. So it is a legend. It's probably not back in the Age of Heroes, but we don't know exactly when it took place. But he was this king beyond the wall, and he was insulted once by the Lord, the King of Winter, Lord Stark, and so he decided to pay him a lesson. He climbed over the wall, came down, got into Winterfell, and assumed a false name, played for the King of Winter, Lord Stark, and at the end of it was asked, what reward do you want? What can I pay you? And he said, I just want the finest flower from your garden. And there was a pail, there was a blue winter rose, and he was given this. And he accepted it. Everyone went to sleep, and the next morning he had disappeared. And they discovered that the King of the North's daughter had also disappeared, and on her bed was laying this single rose. And so they sent out search parties, couldn't find him or her, no idea what happened, until a year later she suddenly returns with a baby, and it turns out that they had been hiding for this time, all this time, down in the Winterfell crypts, and this was now their child. And he, however, had gone and disappeared. I would say never to be seen again, but he was seen again, and he met his son much later, who had by this time become the new Lord of Winterfell, new King of Winter, and he was killed by him, refusing to fight him. And that's the story of Bael the Bard. Now, this has clear forward echoes to Mance Rayder. And not just Mance Rayder, but other elements that we've got going on in this story. But Mance Rayder chimes with a lot of this. He is the king beyond the wall. He goes into Winterfell, which is what he does here, with a false name, which is what happened in the legend. The false name that he has here in this story is Abel the Bard, deliberately close to Bael the Bard, and an anagram of it. And he is, I think, very clearly going to head down into the crypts. His spear wives are asking Theon about how to get access to the crypts. And so, obviously, once they have played their part in getting Theon and Fake Eye out, they have to hide somewhere, and the place they're going to hide is down in the crypts. So that is an immediate echo of the story of Bael the Bard. So there are other echoes, of course, the blue winter rose, which was Lyanna Stark's favorite flower, and that was what Rhaegar presented her with, the crown of them. And obviously she also had a child. I do wonder whether casting this forward, whether this might suggest that he will, Mance Rayder will be killed somehow by the King of the North, by a bastard-born King of the North, perhaps by Jon Snow himself. I don't know, but George R. R. Martin seems to be playing with that. The character himself, Mance Rayder, seems to be playing with that. But I think that the key thing that is that while he's down in the crypts, I think that he is going to explore, because he's not just going to sort of sit there and bide his time and wait to see what happens. He's going to explore the crypts. He is fascinated and spent months, years effectively exploring the crypts north of the wall. And now suddenly he's got access to the crypt south of the wall. So I think he is going to explore it. And I think what he was looking for was the Horn of Winter, and I think what he is going to find is something connected to the Horn of Winter down there, perhaps another part, a necessary part of the broken horn that Sam has got. So anyway, that's the kind of the symbolism and possibly where this might lead. AK Channel TV saying, hi, which family on GAT has the best music? Oh, I think that's a really good question. I'm going to throw that one out to the chat to see if anyone's got any particular thoughts on that. I always like the Lannister stuff, I have to admit, but I'd be really interested to know what other people's thoughts are on that. Marley saying, we know that the Starks were kings in the North. Wardens of the North, were there any other great houses that held the title before the Starks, and besides the Boltons that hold that title now in the books? So not now in the books. Now it's the Boltons who are holding this as being Wardens of the North. The Starks are the ones who have been Wardens of the North. Warden of the North is what they were given as a replacement for being Kings of Winter, because obviously the new kings, the Targaryen kings, didn't want there still to be kings. They wanted to be the only kings, so they had to demote the Starks to being lords and wardens. So they have been the only wardens of the North. Before that, as I say, there were lots of petty kings with some fantastic names, like the Walk King and the Marsh Kings and things like that. None of them, however, claimed the title of being King of the North. The only people who have had this ever have been, as far as we're aware, have been the Starks, and then now the Boltons have claimed the Warden of the North title. Carlito King, there must always be a Stark in Winterfell. Which one was in Winterfell during the tourney at Harrenhal? That was Rickard Stark. So the father of the Ned and all the rest of it. So what seemed to have happened in terms of sort of the iteration of which Stark was in Winterfell when during that period was that they were all there, broadly speaking, during the winter, although Ned obviously had been fostered in the Eyrie, and Brandon also had had his fostering as well. But when we get the Year of the Full Spring and everyone thinks it is spring, there's this tourney announced, and then Rickard basically says, okay, my children, you can go, you can explore, you've been stuck up home here for a long time, go down, you can join this tourney. So the four children head down, Rickard himself stays in Winterfell, but there is going to be a wedding. There is going to be a wedding of Brandon Stark, his heir, to Catelyn Tully. And obviously Rickard wants to be there for that. So the idea was that after the tourney, Benjen heads back up north. When Benjen arrives in Winterfell, they sort of like do tag team. Benjen arrives, who's still a young boy at this time, and then Rickard heads down south. Benjen then stays in Winterfell throughout Robert's Rebellion. Ned appears there briefly when he sort of heads back up, calls the banners. But Benjen stays there throughout Robert's Rebellion. Then when Ned arrives back up north, and when Rob, baby Rob at the time, arrives, that's when Benjen heads to the north. So that's the sort of the iteration of which Stark was in Winterfell during that period. Question from Lee Roberts. Hi, Robert. Hope all is well. Thank you. And Happy New Year to you as well. Can you talk a little bit about the history of Moat Cailin and its connection to the Children of the Forest? It's one of the North's most important strongholds and commands the only safe route through the Neck that an army coming from the south can take, but it seems abandoned in times of peace. Why do you think this is? Thanks for your content. So Moat Cailin, I think, has, with the possible exception of places like the High Tower, the base of the High Tower, has a claim to be one of the oldest castles out there. Now, perhaps even the oldest. It's alleged to be 10,000 years old, so older even than Winterfell. Now, it was, when it was built originally, this was large. It was very big. It had a huge curtain wall, higher than Winterfell, we're told, lots of towers. It had a wooden keep. And over time, I'll get back to the Children of the Forest link in a moment, but over time, then it seems to have been used less and less as a sort of a home and more as a strategic place to prevent anyone in the north heading north. So by the time we get to where we're at in the story, it's largely sunk into the marshland, basically. The walls, there are little bits of, it's made out of this kind of black basalt stone, and there's bits of them sticking up, but only three towers remain. The wooden keep is long gone. Now, so what is left? Just these three towers. And these three towers, however, are still strategically placed that if you're wishing to head through them, then they create a killing ground between them, which makes it very hard for anyone attacking from the south to get through. Now, so that's where we're at. From the north, they're much more vulnerable. So the connection with the Children of the Forest is that one of those three towers is called the Children's Tower. because the legend is that the Children of the Forest, from the top of the Children's Tower, they cast, when the First Men were sort of invading up through Westeros, they cast this huge, mighty spell called the Hammer of the Waters, which had sundered the land bridge between Dorne and Essos, and left just the Stepstones, all those tiny islands. So having done that successfully, prevented any more First Men coming in, they now realize that actually these humans, they breed like crazy. They're not going to stop coming. Now they're here, they're just going to keep on moving. So then they wanted to do it again. This seems to have been their second attempt to stop this. And so they, at the top of the Children's Tower, the legend goes, they tried again to cast the Hammer of the Waters, but this time across the neck. So cutting off the north before the humans, the First Men, could populate the north, cut off at the neck. This, however, was not as successful. And what we're left with is the marshland. So, yes, there was lots of extra water suddenly appeared, but not enough to completely cut off the north. So this one was also a failure. They tried to stop the humans coming, the First Men coming first time. They tried the second time. And the best understanding we have of the situation is that the third attempt that they made to stop them was the creation of the others, or however that is going to be revealed in the books. But what does this imply? This implies that the Moat Cailin itself was somehow at that point in time associated with the children. Now, had they built it? That seems unlikely, because they didn't live in castles. They lived in the deep forests. They lived in caves. So this seems to have been built by the First Men, but some First Men who were already closely linked in with the Children of the Forest, or maybe the children just did take the castle from them. The castle was built and then the children took it away. We're not entirely sure. But since then, it does seem to, as I say, it seems to have sunk down into the marshland itself. And the link between the children and the Crannog men the people who live there, does remain strong. So we don't know the details, but that is the history that we have been told. Carlito King, just picking up, I think, on your previous question about Rickard, saying, shouldn't he have been there at Harrenhal, I assume, for the secret meeting? Well, no, because this wasn't called as a secret meeting. So Harrenhal was a secret meeting, but the intention was just to attract all of the lords from the land for Rhaegar, and Rhaegar, when they were there, he would then show his prowess as a potential king and try to get them on his side. He did not send out lots of invites saying, please come here for this secret meeting where we can discuss overthrowing the current king and putting me in his place. That was not, that would have blown his cover immediately. Instead, the idea was to put a huge prize pot, because there was a huge prize pot, to time it just when everybody had been cooped up at home in the winter for a very long time, and get everybody in there. So at a central place that everybody could get to. So that was the plan. It wasn't that he wasn't inviting people to a secret meeting. He was going to have a meeting when, or a great council effectively, when they were all there. Wafflemaster06, thank you for the super chat. Apologies for the off-topic question, but in your opinion, why hasn't technology progressed beyond a certain point in all of Planetos? Has magic hindered science? Yes, It has. It's a good question, because what you see actually is, when you look across the piece, you see that the most amazing things, feats of engineering, are all ancient. The wall is ancient. The high tower is ancient. All of these things that you look as being these great wonders of the world, they tend to be ancient. The five forts are ancient. The technology does not, certainly in things like engineering, does not seem to have progressed. Also in terms, and this is over thousands of years, don't forget, also in terms of sort of technology of other things, warfare. We've got less information on more mundane things like farming equipment or whatever, but there doesn't seem to have been a huge level of advancement. Now, the general answer to this in Westeros is that the maesters have been keeping a hold of knowledge and not disseminating it out. What you could do if you have all that knowledge is you could try and teach as many people as possible and open up the research to as many people as possible to try and get as much innovation as possible, but the maesters don't do that. They keep a very closed circle of people who can access the information, and the people who go out to advise the lords and ladies of the world are people who have been trained in-house. So that's one definite answer of what's happening in Westeros. It doesn't, however, explain what's happened in Essos. Essos is a lot more complicated. It's not and more heterogeneous, is probably a better way of saying it, than Westeros. In some areas, there are some instances where technology does seem to have advanced a little bit. So, for example, you get mirrorish lenses. We get one, Maester Luwin gets sent one at the very beginning of Game of Thrones, and this is effectively, it's a spyglass, it's a telescope. So that certainly seems to have been developed. You get in Braavos, they seem to have developed mass production. And almost a mini industrial revolution. They can build a warship in a day, apparently, which is astonishingly quick. And the Titan of Braavos is not just a very impressive engineering feat, but it also it acts as an early warning system for any invasions or anything like that. If anyone's coming into Braavos, it sounds a horn. So Braavos seems to be moving forward with technology. Now, that sort of explains some of things, but doesn't give the whole answer. The whole answer, I suspect George R. R. Martin would say, it's magic. And I think that's probably right, is that if you have magic out there that you can do all of these amazing things, then that has to be a dampener on just technological development, because why on earth would you develop lots of things over a long period of time if you can just get a glass candle? Why do you need to be developing the telephone when you can see things over long distances already? If the magical things are there, then the need for the technology is not there. George R. R. Martin has kept magic relatively low key in the first half of his story, but the deeper in we go, the more we understand that magic has, particularly in Essos, has permeated huge amounts of the world, and that is a dampener on technological progress. I think that's me caught up on questions in the chat. I will come back, as I always do, towards the end. I'll try and pick up as many. If I've missed any, I'll try and pick up some more there. But I have a few more questions from my patrons. Question from Julia Erickson. Hello, Robert. Do you think that the reforging of ice could be a way for George R. R. Martin to remind us of the dark sides of the Stark heritage if we look beyond their strong sense of honour? If ice symbolises the Starks and Oathkeeper is extracted from it, the part which is left is a widow's wail. Perhaps honour and deaths could also be two parts of the same coin, at least in Ned's case. If he had gone home and ignored the Lannisters, he would have prevented many widows' wails. Yes, so Ned did, of course, want to go home and very nearly managed to get home, but got waylaid on the way. The Starks, yes, they have a sense of honour, but we shouldn't pretend that they're all shininess and love and patience and happiness and good things. There are bad Starks, and the characters of all of the Starks are grey in different ways. So we can't, yes, the Starks, and this is deliberate on George R. R. Martin's part. When you look at the POV characters we have in book one, which is when we're establishing our sympathies for the characters, we have POVs for Ned, Arya, Sansa, Catelyn, Jon, lots of Starks. We do not, and Bran, of course, we have, to start with, only Tyrion of the Lannisters, and it only later sort of expands out. George R. R. Martin wanted us to be sympathetic to the Starks right from the beginning, and so we are naturally sympathetic, but we shouldn't turn a blind eye to the fact that they have good and bad parts to their characters as well. When you're talking about ice, the reforging of ice into the two parts of Oathkeeper and Widow's Wail, I think there are many layers to this. The one that I've mentioned a couple of times recently, which I personally like, is that George R. R. Martin is reflecting for us a little bit of what happened at the Tower of Joy and Ned himself, because ice is associated not just with House Stark, but with Ned. He was the last holder of ice. And this, the two things which were for two swords which were forged from it, are very much reflective of what happened at the Tower of Joy. A widow's wail, Lyanna Stark, we hear her cries, and Oathkeeper, Ned Stark keeping his promises to her. And so I think that that is very much a kind of a clue and a hint and a reflection of what happened there at the Tower of Joy. Now, does this talk about the Starks' character more broadly? Yes, it probably does. I think that we should keep both parts of that together, Widow's Wail and Oathkeeper. And I think that the fact that they are now effectively with House Lannister shows that they also have a couple of different sides. Jaime is has many bad aspects to him, but he also did do some honourable things, and so he will live up to this Oath Keeper in many ways. So it is reflective of the Starks, but it's also reflective, I think, of the Lannisters. Lady Pushkin's saying, "Hi, Robert. You've no doubt heard about the missing raven from the Tower of London and the associated legends connected to it. I wonder if Westeros would fall if Bloodraven died. Do you know the Welsh word for raven is Bran?" I did know that the Welsh word for raven is Bran. For those who don't know, the Tower of London, they keep ravens there, and they are, incidentally, I've not been to the Tower of London for a while, but when I went there, they are very impressive, it has to be said, much larger birds than you might first think, and they can talk. Ravens can learn quite a few words and phrases, and they also are very intelligent, and there is a legend that the ravens must stay at the Tower of London. Half a dozen ravens must be at the Tower of London, and if the ravens ever leave, fly away, then the tower would fall and so would the kingdom. That is the legend. And obviously, the powers that be at the Tower of London don't want the tower to fall and the kingdom to fall, so they keep more than six. So they normally have eight. One of them, however, recently escaped the Tower of London. Apparently it did used to sort of wander off every now and then. Their wings are clipped, so they can't fly away. But it went and it didn't return, and so it is now assumed dead. Ravens, incidentally, live a very long time. Another thing I hadn't realized, they live to 40 or 50 sometimes, even some of those ravens. So they're very well looked after, obviously, so perhaps ravens in the wild don't live quite that long. But yes, one of the ravens has gone. They are going to replace it, though, I am sure. Does this have any reference across to A Song of Ice and Fire? Would Westeros fall if Bloodraven died? I don't think Westeros will fall if Bloodraven died. I like the idea. I like the thinking. And it's a fantastic real world legend. But I don't think George R.R. Martin has picked it, other than the clear fact that ravens are very intelligent and they can retain messages. Theoretically, you could teach a raven to say something and then it would say it back to you, so you can do that. That I think he is definitely taken, but I don't think the sort of reference across to Bloodraven is necessarily there. Question from Mr. E. Knight, thank you very much, saying the Weirwood Network resembles an eternal consciousness that could be what Melisandre refers to as the Great Other, which sees all and influences the minds across vast distances, which reminds me of the sentience within the One Ring, tethering Sauron to Middle Earth. I can see George R. R. Martin ending with Bran as king, actually controlled by the Great Other, as the bittersweet ending, unless a key Weirwood is destroyed. Really interesting thoughts. Pardon me. So the Great Other, we should be clear on the Great Other. The Great Other is in this kind of Manichaean worldview that the Red Priest, the Priest of Law, have. This is the opposite, the bad guy god to their god. Now, the only people who talk about this are the Red Priests. George R. R. Martin has said we will never see the gods in A Song of Ice and Fire, so we're never going to get that kind of level of understanding that this is, you know, that here is the Great Other doing this. And I very much suspect that as this is just what Melisandre believes, it may well not be the truth. We will never see R'hllor, and we're never going to see the Great Other. But what is important is what she thinks. And if she thinks, as she seems to be starting to think, that the Bloodraven and Bran, who she's seen in the flames, might be the Great Other, that I think is going to be very important for the plot moving forward, because suddenly they become her enemy, regardless of what they do. Everybody who doesn't believe in R'hllor is a heretic in her eyes, but the top of the tree of the heretics, the big baddie, is the Great Other. And if she thinks for one moment that the Weirwood Network is, then yes, she absolutely will try and burn it, as you say. You can follow the train of logic down quite a long way to the burning of the Weirwood Network, but clearly fire is not good for trees. Question from I didn't actually copy across who this was from, but thank you, whichever patron this was from, saying if the mermen are Manderleys and starfish soup are Boltons, could the serving crabs be a small force Davos brings from Skagos? Just trying to puzzle out one of Patchface's creepy quotes. Okay, so for those who don't know, so Patchface, book-only character, comes out with some very strange phrases that seem prophetic. Some of them you can kind of pick out what they might be, or not prophetic is probably the wrong way, but just seeing the world in a different way. He often starts these random sayings with under the sea, such and such, and then I know, or something like that at the end of it. So they follow a broad pattern. What this thing here that you're talking about, he says, under the sea, the mermen feast on starfish soup, and all the surfing men are crabs. Now, what I would suggest with Patchface is that we shouldn't, whereas a lot of the prophecies that we see, the visions that we see, we kind of understand the language and we can put the a person in a place of a symbol and things like that, because that seems to be how it's working. I don't think we should attempt that with Patchface. So when I say that for most we can try and sort of match up one thing for another, when we have green dreams and visions about a chained wolf with wings, then we can go through it. A wolf, that must mean stark. Wings, flying. Flying equates to magic in Bloodraven's sort of world. Being chained down means that you can't fly, so you can't do magic. So that is Bran, who is should be magical but can't be magical right now. We can go through that kind of chain of logic. It's almost like a cryptic crossword if you know the keys, the kind of the meter, the understanding of what it is that we're going through, then we can interpret it. I suggest that we don't try and do that with Patchface, because I think Patchface is simply, yes, he sees stuff, but he is just repeating out his stuff from his own perspective, which is under the sea, which is almost as kind of a mirror image of a lot of what is there. Sometimes we can pick things out and go, ah, yes, that works. And so mermen, yes, that is quite possibly a reference to the Manderleys. Starfish soup, we then have to start kind of like scrabbling around. What does that mean? There's no obvious starfish. I think there's a very minor house. There's a starfish as a sigil. But I think the more the serving men are crabs, does that mean some people from Cracklaw Point or somewhere like that? Where there's, I think that this way lies madness. We should probably try and take a lot of what he says just in the context of what is going on here. He doesn't just come out with this whole series of, here's a series of prophecies, guys, try and interpret these. They are heading off, he's just in this group of people who are heading off to have a big meal and a feast effectively at the wall. And then he's just sort of saying, under the sea, the mermen feast on starfish soup and all the serving men are crabs. That's just his worldview, because he sees everything as if he's under the sea. Now, does this possibly have some kind of extra implication? Maybe, but George R. R. Martin on this particular one has not made it clear enough for us to interpret at this stage, I would say. It's the kind of thing that we can, the prophecy that we might be able to see on the way back, looking back at it, that, you know, the mermen feast on starfish soup and all the serving men are crabs. Maybe there will be Manderleys at a feast somewhere eating starfish soup, and then some people are snapping somewhere in the background. I don't know. I just made that up off the top. We will only be able to see looking backward and go, oh yes, that's what he saw. Trying, I think, at this stage to pick it out based upon sigils, house sigils or something like that, I think is probably not going to be particularly helpful. Muz Zai, thank you so much. Very generous super chat saying, thanks everyone for instructing me on how to do this. Ah, well, the chat is a fantastic place. There are many excellent and helpful people there. No question, just wanted to say hi to Robert and the community. Thank you for keeping us going through the long night. I'm a long time fan. Well, Thank you so much. That's incredibly kind of you and very generous. So thank you. And yeah, I feel very touched by the community that is here, that meets together in the chat every week. If I can play my part in helping people through this period, then I'm going to be very happy with that, it has to be said. And yeah, so thank you. That's very kind. We're back in lockdown here. Just for those who don't know, in the UK, we're back in lockdown for a while. Who's to say? The vaccines are rolling out, but it will still take some time. And for those who asked, no, I did not manage to get my hair cut before lockdown, so who knows what it's going to look like in a few weeks' time. Sylvester Snow, hi Robert, would you mind explaining Skagos's relationship with the North and mainland Westeros? Are they a part of the Seven Kingdoms, or are they more akin to the Wildlings? What role, if any, will the Skagosi play after Davos's trip there? So Skagos are technically a part of the Seven Kingdoms. But when I say technically, that means that the Starks consider them a part of the North, but Skagos do not. Now, the Skagos is off of the East Coast, very north, and frankly, there's not much benefit to the Starks going in there, imposing their law, and then going away because the Skagosi would just like shrug their shoulders and carry on afterwards. It is not a particularly pleasant. There's lots of wild rumours about it, but cannibalism and all the rest of it, and unicorns there. These are, we think, just one horned goat, so goats. So that seems to be what's going on there. So Davos going there, as he is about to, or has, depending on when we next see Davos, is him going outside of the world of the Seven Kingdoms. Certainly the Skagosi wouldn't recognize anybody's authority over them. Now, will he be coming back with some Skagosi? I personally think not. I think the lack of civilization is probably too harsh a phrase there, but the apparent lack of cities and towns, and the fact that it's a lot more wild an environment on Skagos, I think probably means that what's happened, this is, so Rickon has gone there with Shaggy Dog, and Osha has been leading them there. She's obviously a wildling, and so she will be absolutely fine and looking after them and taking them over to Skagos and them looking after themselves. Maybe they'll find a cave or something like that, who knows. And surely Shaggy Dog is perfectly capable not just of defending them, but also of catching food and all the rest of it. So they will be absolutely fine. And there is no reason to think that they are going to be sort of mixing with Skagosi society to any great extent. Indeed, we do get a John vision through Ghost connected into Shaggy Dog. We think that's what it was, that had a vision of a horny goat. A goat with one large horn, that seemed to imply that that was indeed where Rickon was at the time. So Davos, probably assuming he manages to persuade them to come with him back to White Harbor to meet up with the Manderlys, then they're not necessarily taking any Skagosi with them. In fact, why on earth would the Skagosi be interested? They don't care about the politics of the Seven Kingdoms. They don't care about who sits in Winterfell. That has got nothing to do with their daily lives whatsoever. So as much as I love this idea of the Skagosi coming charging across the north, riding their horned goats, the nice, I don't think this is going to happen. I think we're just going to get Rickon and Osha and Shaggy Dog returning. Question from Sylvester Snow. In what way do you think the others will cross the wall in the books? It seems highly unlikely they will acquire a dragon-like on the show, and I'm of the same mind as you that the Horn of Winter awakens the statues in the crypts of Winterfell. Will it have something to do with the Nightfort, or perhaps Bran and Bloodraven in some way? By the way, yes, thank you. I spotted, who was it? Somebody in the chat said, community, Crack and Tacos, thank you, saying community hug for Robert. Thank you. That's very sweet. In terms of the wall, so we've got a little bit of extra information on this recently. In Fire Cannot Kill a Dragon, then we get... It's, if you're interested in the TV show and the background to it, then there's a lot of stuff in there. But there are, and I did a video with, I think, 8 takeaway points for the books, because we do get interviews with George R.R. Martin and interviews with the showrunners in which they talk about things connected in with the books, and also things that they devised just for the show. Now, what that means is that we can then, and we shouldn't, I completely agree, you know, we shouldn't be taking what's in the show as an indication of what's in the books. But when the showrunner specifically said that they had to come up with something in order to do stuff, because it's not that the things aren't in play that would be in the books, then we can draw some conclusions. And they said it was their idea. They made up the idea that a dragon would burn down the wall. Then they had to figure out how the White Walkers could get a dragon, and that's how we got that Beyond the Wall episode. So that was all them. That was their doing, and they said that they were trying to think of how could the wall come down, because they didn't want to introduce something late in the day just as this kind of like wonderful magical thing to bring the wall down. Now, what we can draw a conclusion from that is a dragon does not, in the books, a dragon does not do, that we can be sure of this, a dragon does not burn down the wall. The others will not get a dragon in order to do that. So the wall comes down some other way, because I think we can be reasonably sure that the others will breach the wall. Now, I think that there are, and I think you've very helpfully laid out the three biggest or most likely options we've got here. The first is the Horn of Winter. The Horn of Winter is an ancient magical artifact that we're told by some people in legend brings down the wall. Indeed, that was the whole point of why Mance Rayder was looking for it, because of this legend, and he was going to threaten to blow it to bring down the wall if they didn't let them through. Now, it was blown back in legend, and as far as we can tell, the wall didn't collapse. So whether or not this does this is quite open to debate, and for reasons that are far too intricate to go into in this live stream, so I will refer you back onto my videos for this. I personally think that the role of the Horn of Winter is to be awakening the Stark dead, specifically probably the statues in the Winterfell crypt. I think that is the role of it. That is the thing that we are told, waking giants from the earth, raising giants from the earth, is what we're told it did do when it was blown before. So that, I think, is what its role is. Which leaves two other prime candidates. George R. R. Martin might shift our mind on this during the Winds of Winter. There might be other things coming in, but as it stands, we've got two other prime candidates. Candidate number one is some kind of way, a link between Bran and the others, the White Walkers, that allows them to get past magical barriers. There is a magical barrier. And again, we shouldn't take what was in the show as being exactly what's going to happen in the books. But in the books, there is a magical protection, a magical barrier that goes around the outside of Bloodraven's cave. That was there when they got in there, when Bran and co. got in there. In the first case, that prevented the whites, the skeletons, from getting in. So there is that magical protection. And I think it is reasonably likely that they will somehow get in. The whites, the others, will get in through that barrier in some way. If that magic is the same magic as what is in the wall, then I think that gives us a clue to how they could get across. Now, is that going to be some strange bond between the Night King, who doesn't obviously exist in the books, but and Bran? Probably not exactly like that, but however they get into Bloodraven's cave, if they do, probably gives us a clue to how they could get across past the wall, because the wall, it's not the physical wall, it's a magical barrier. That's the thing that they can't get past. So those are the first two things, the Horn of Winter, or however they get past the barrier that we've been told about in Bloodraven's cave. And the third option, you say, what about the Night Fort? Now, the Night Fort has a magical door through the wall, the Black Gate. And the way to get through that is by giving the right answer. Now, we don't know any more than that, but it clearly, if somebody gave the right answer, then it opened up and it let everybody go through. Now, we don't know the details of how that magic works. Does this create a hole in the magical barrier that they can go, that people can then pass through? We do not know. But that is, at the moment, the most suspicious thing. You do not create this hugely complicated door, a face with sort of weirwood connections and a mouth that opens up and you walk through the mouth and it's asking you questions. You don't create something that intricate that's hidden away inside a well in the place that was the center of the Night's Watch power, the Night Fort, that has so many legends about it. He has created so much to do with the Night Fort. He's not just going to abandon it. There is some purpose to the Night Fort and that door, the Black Gate. It probably isn't that's where the others are going to come through. But if there is one magical hole in the wall, that is it. So those at the moment are my three candidates for how they get there, how they get past the wall. It won't be with a dragon. It might be with some kind of magical implement. The only one that we've heard of that's ever been rumored to do that is the Horn of Winter. It might be however they get past and into Bloodraven's cave, or it might be through this magical door that we know exists. Shannon Adams, what do you see as the real world cognates for the various northern groups, e.g. Hulls, Norries, Flints, Scottish Highlanders, Barrington, the Crannogmen, etc.? I'm not seeing this as a one-to-one comparison, just wondering what echoes from the real world you see in the different houses or regions of the north. Yeah, I think that it's clearly there is no George R. Martin in the north hasn't done picking up a house or city in the north and said, well, I'm now dropping that into Westeros. That's not the way that he works, but he does take inspiration. One thing that I would say, he enjoys playing with the names. So House Bolton. Bolton is a town in the north of England, and he has got a house called Bolton. The Flints, there is Flintshire, which is, I think it's in North Wales, which is, and Wales obviously is a very mountainous kind of country. So he's done a lot of this. I also saw somebody recently, I can't, I think it was on Reddit, when somebody pointed out that if you do take the map as being roughly matching up to the United Kingdom with a bit of Ireland on it, there is where Bear Island is, there is that roughly maps onto where there is an island off the coast of the north of England, which is the Isle of Man. And why is that significant? Well, the Isle of Man, the notable thing about Bear Island? Well, it's run by women. And I suspect that that is probably George R. R. Martin having a little bit of a joke to himself about that. So I think that he plays a lot with the names in terms of the actual houses or groups of houses. Obviously, we get the Starks sort of House York. The others, I don't think he's particular. I'd love any thoughts of anyone in the chat. I'll try and pick up on anything that people do come up with. In terms of sort of the Crannogmen, then yes, there is very clearly this. If you go back to sort of Viking times, then a lot of the east of England and heading across down also towards the south was quite marshy, and there would be lots of people. So King Alfred hid away in the marshlands, and so he got a lot of inspiration. I'm sure George R. R. Martin, because he loves Bernard Cornwell, who has written a lot of stories at Last Kingdom. That's his series. George R. R. Martin is a huge fan of that, and I think that he probably took inspiration sort of the marshland and the importance of that as a defensive structure. That may well have played across into the Crannogmen. But I'd be interested to see if there's any more ideas that people might have in the chat. Stephanie Spain, thank you so much. Saying, just wanted to say thank you for your wonderful content. I always look forward to Thursdays. Thank you. That means a lot. Shannon Adams, do you think Ned was ever aware of Roose Bolton's violent character or his ambition? What textual evidence do you see for this? So I think there's not much here, but the history between the Boltons, who clearly were envious, everybody has said this, the Boltons were clearly envious and wanted, were ambitious, and Roose Bolton had that. So there's a sort of general background to it. But you don't get it so much from Ned, but you do get it from a few other people. So I think there's a point at which John says something like, my father never trusted Roose Bolton. So clearly Ned was aware of the character of Roose Bolton. And Theon, definitely one of his reflections is, you know, I can't remember the exact quote, but everyone who saw Roose Bolton immediately by the look in his eyes could see that he was a lot more cruel than the phrase could ever be. And that, I think, is a hint that everybody could see this. It's not so Ned probably never completely trusted him, but the Boltons were bannermen of the Starks. And so, yes, he had to rely on them and trusted them to a certain degree. But the implication is that people generally felt a little bit uncertain around Roose Bolton, and Ned himself in private with his family did voice some personal concerns about the trustworthiness of him. So there's not much there, because Ned's not around for huge amounts, and frankly Ned and Roose, he's not thinking about Roose Bolton most of the time. He's in the north, worried about going down to King's Landing, or in King's Landing. He's not thinking about his bannermen all that much. Question from Barus Aurelius. Thank you very much. Saying, is it possible the Lord Commander can lead the others through the wall via the Black Gate? This might explain why Othel went for the old bear. As a white, might John be whited to start at the start of the Winds of Winter. It's possible. So Sam could get through the Black Gate by basically reciting the first part of the Night's Watch Oath. And what we don't know, because we do not know the mechanism of this, but what we don't know is whether it's simply the words. Is this just a password, in which case anyone could go through? We don't know who can follow through. Clearly the others weren't members of the Night's Watch, so the whatever magic was there would allow people to be escorted through by people who knew the password. And we also don't know about the magical barrier. That is it creating a hole in the magical barrier? That is the key important part here, because if the magical barrier goes all the way through, then it doesn't actually matter, because that seems to be stopping the others from passing through. Now, the thing about the magical barrier, again, we don't know huge amounts about it, but what we're told is that it's set into the foundations of the wall. Now, that's an interesting phraseology, because it's not, as I say, the wall started at a normal wall height and then got added to all this time. So actually, the implication is that the magic might not be just all the way up and down. There might be a way under it. Now, there are legends of caves and things under the wall, but in order to get to the Black Gate, you have to go down. Now, this then is into a well in the kitchens of the Night Fort. This is interesting, because if the spells are in the foundations, perhaps going through the Black Gate, you're going under the foundations. It's all speculation, because we haven't been told deliberately. The Night Fort is supposed to be mysterious. You're wondering whether the Lord Commander could lead others through the wall via the Black Gate. It's possible. Might John be whited to start at the start of the Winds? So my take on this, because I think it's quite an important point, is that John is not going to be a white. Now, George R. R. Martin did talk a while ago about fire whites as opposed to ice whites. He talked about how Beric was a fire white, and how this was important because it was the precursor for John. I think that at the time, a lot of us kind of said, oh, so that means that John is going to be a fire white like Beric. But I don't think that's necessarily what George R. R. Martin was specifically saying there. What he was saying was that you could come back as a lot of who you were. You would lose some of yourself when you came back, but you could come back and not automatically be turned into like the Ice Whites, like just sort of a zombie figure. You could come back being somebody. The first time Beric came back, he was still very much a good guy who could remember a lot of stuff and was still trying to do the right things. And so that was setting the ground for when John returns, we can believe that he can be still similar to who he is. So when John returns, he is, first of all, he's not going to die. His spirit, his soul, whatever it is going to go into ghost. This is, I think, pretty clearly foreshadowed, not just by Varamyr Sixskins, who was in the prologue chapter of that book, that showing that you could, as a skin changer, you can go into your wolf's body after your physical body is killed. But also, I think it's shown throughout, there's a lot of foreshadowing throughout that last John chapter. But anyway, so John's spirit, soul, is going to go into his body. His body is going to be frozen in the ice cells. Again, there's a lot of foreshadowing for that. In that last chapter, his body is going to be there. His body will be thawed out, and then his spirit is going to be, soul or whatever, is going to be removed from Ghost and put back into his body. So it's not that he's died and sort of gone off into the void or whatever, and then he's returned sometime later. He is still going to be conscious all the way through this period, but within Ghost. Think that's me caught up there in the chat. I've got a few more questions from my patrons. We have to keep us going for a little bit more. Catherine Firsith saying, "Hi, Robert. I was wondering about the symbolism of the North. In a lot of countries, the northern parts are considered tough, cold, desolate, in some ways old-fashioned and tribal. That's certainly the case in my country and to some degrees in the UK. Symbols like ice and snow, whiteness and purity are often strong. What are the main features or characteristics George R. R. Martin wants us to connect with his North?" I think you've covered it really well there, it has to be said. So he's very much sort of, as we know, a lot of inspiration originally came from the United Kingdom, the British Isles. The North is colder. It's I'm from the south of England, so I have to be very careful not to paint too bleak a picture of the North, because huge swathes of the North are wondrous and beautiful. But it is a lot colder, and the stereotype is that the people are a lot more plain spoken than perhaps down in the south. So that's a lot more of the kind of the feel that's been going on there. And so the accents, particularly when they were making the show, they were trying to, Sean Bean's got a Sheffield accent from the north up in Yorkshire, and that was very much the feel that they were trying to generate there. Now, so what is he trying to make us feel by thinking about the North in Northern Hemisphere? I think you're very right. In a lot of Northern Hemisphere countries, then this is the feel of the North part of the country, is that it's, you're having to face real life a lot more. The elements, the weather, are against you in a way that perhaps in more temperate climes they're not, and that impacts on the lifestyle of people, and that impacts on the character of people. And that, I think, is what he's trying to show, is that the character of people from the North is a result of what the life they have to lead is, in the same way that the character of the people in the South is a reflection of the kind of life that they lead is. People talk about in Brazil, yes. So in Southern Hemisphere countries, obviously the opposite is often the case, that the further south you go, then the sort of the colder it is and all the rest of it. So you get to places like Argentina, then you get the south is a lot more like that. Question from Mara Lee saying, Leanna Mormont on the show, when putting in her vote for Jon Snow as King of the North, says the North remembers. What does that really mean in the books? What does the North need to remember? Does it have anything to do with the others, the First Pact, or the First Long Night? Yeah, I think it's the North remembers about all of those things, but specifically what has to be done in order to fight the others when they return, because when the others come back, then the fact that there are going to be a clear and present danger, you do not need to remember that. But what the North would have to remember is what has to be done, and what has to be done is I think blowing the Horn of Winter contacting the Children of the Forest, using Dragonglass, those kinds of things that the Bloodraven is trying to push the Starks, particularly Jon and Bran, towards. Ellen, this is a sort of North question, but where do you think Val will fit in this story? I think Val, for those who don't know, is a Northern, what they call her, a Northern princess. She doesn't consider herself to be that. She's a wildling and very beautiful and very capable and competent and charismatic. She is going to have at least one important role, I think. She has very strongly come out and saying that Shireen should be killed because of the grayscale. And I think that she has got a very influential voice at Castle Black. And I think that when there is a discussion is probably too weak a word for this. When Melisandre tries to do it and various people are arguing for and against it, I think her voice will be one of the key ones which sways people, sways the wildlings to be allowing this to happen. Melisandre will be doing it not because, you know, she'll be doing it because she's trying to do some magic, but Val thinks that the grayscale, you have to just get rid of it or it might spread. So I think that's going to be her first and main role. But I think that she's going to be a leader of the wildlings going forward. Mance Rayder is down in Winterfell. She is going to be playing a key role in Castle Black when the wildlings are going to be heading off in various other places. So that's what she's going to be doing, I think. Well, Witzer saying, "Hello, Robert. I've been fascinated with Stannis's march towards Winterfell. The march echoes Napoleon and Hitler's failed invasions of Russia. Would you please discuss and compare Stannis's march with that of Napoleon's and Hitler's?" Yes. So for those who don't know, back in 1812, Napoleon attempted to invade Russia, and his forces marched deeper and deeper into Russia, and the Russian forces sort of tried to slow them on their way, but generally just slowly retreated back and just did a scorched earth policy, destroying everything there so that the French had no way of foraging and feeding off of the army off of the land. And the further into Russia they got, the deeper into winter it got, until finally Napoleon, the great military commander, had to admit that he had to turn back, and the army went back, and he gave up on this idea of taking on Russia, and many of the French soldiers died in this attempt to invade Russia. And the biggest factor was the weather. It wasn't the Russian army who were there, but the biggest factor was the weather. And incidentally, that's where the 1812 overture comes from, if you are a music fan. Back in the Second World War, Germany attempted to attack Russia, pushed into Russia. The Russians did the same thing, just scorched earth, keep on moving back. And there was a very long and horrible battle around Stalingrad. And eventually the Russian winter did it for the German army as well, and they lost huge amounts of people to the winter, and the Russians pushed them back as well. And this has sort of gone down in military history as one of the things that, you know, never start a land war in Asia, don't try and attack Russia during winter time, that kind of thing. So there's a clear historical example there that George R. R. Martin, yes, I think he has drawn inspiration for that for Stannis. So Stannis wants to take Winterfell. He knows he has to take Winterfell. John advised him to go the long way around via the mountain clans, to gather them via Deepwood Mott, to take that back, and then head through the Wolf's Wood and attack Winterfell from the west rather than from the northeast. Now, that probably did gather a few extra soldiers for Stannis and some more of the north on his side. But by the time he has reached Winterfell, the winter has started to get bad, really, really bad. At Winterfell itself, we're told, you know, there are dozens of feet high snow drifts. Six of the seven gates are frozen shut. They can't open them because the weather is just too cold. The army are camped. His army are now camped in a crofter's village a few days away from Winterfell, and people are dying. They're having to kill their horses to eat them just to stay alive. The feeling is very much there that this is very much like what happened in history. Roose Bolton is in this kind of analogy, I mean, it's not a perfect analogy, but he is playing the role of the Russians, and he is very aware of the importance of winter in this. He is sat in Winterfell, as we've already talked, the advantage of Winterfell is it has the hot springs. He has now, he's chucked out the Freys and the Manderleys. He's probably got enough to feed himself and his garrison for quite a while, and that was part of the reason for getting the Freys and the Manderleys out, because they were starting to eat into his supplies. Roose Bolton is clever. He understands these kind of tactical situations, and so his plan is just to sit inside Winterfell and let the weather deal with Stannis. He sent out the Manderleys and the Freys, but from his perspective, if they just attack each other and leave Stannis alone, it doesn't actually make huge amounts of difference to his plan, because his plan is that the longer Stannis just dilly-dallies, then the fewer men Stannis will have, the worse shape they're going to be in. So, yes, this is a classic setup that Stannis has to attack at some point soon. Now, Melisandre will see this, and this is why on the show we get Shireen sacrificed just to clear the snows, and it didn't seem like such a big thing because they didn't show the depths of winter on the show. This really is the depth of winter. There's actually can Stannis even get to Winterfell is now an issue, because the snow drifts are going to be so horrendous, because the horses are dying, because the army themselves are getting very diminished. So suddenly Melisandre having to cast a weather spell to clear the snows to warm the temperatures up a bit. Actually, that's a matter not just of let's just get the last bit of the way up to Winterfell. This is suddenly a matter of life and death. So the weather is going to play a huge amount of influence in the Winds of Winter. And it's not just the Winds of Winter is not just as a title. It's not just a reference to, you know, here are dark and bad things coming. Yes, it is. But the winds, the literal winds of winter, are going to play a huge part in the developing plot in the north. Horizontal, thank you for the super chat, saying, are Martin's writings allegorical like Tolkien? Well, Tolkien's are not allegorical. I can understand why you might think so, but Tolkien himself felt very strongly about this, to the extent that the introduction to The Lord of the Rings, if you ever read it, is a few pages of rant about why this isn't an allegory and why allegory is bad. Tolkien recognized that nobody can write or create anything that is not influenced by who they are and what they've been through and what their passions and interests are and all the rest of it. But he notoriously was rather withering of C.S. Lewis's creations of Narnia, because he disliked allegory so much, and the Narnia stories are very allegorical Christian allegory. Tolkien talked about applicability. He wanted things to be applicable. He wanted us to be able to draw life lessons. He wanted to create a mythology. That was his original idea, to create a mythology for the English peoples, that we would be able to, like with all myths, we would be able to discuss and take life lessons from and draw inspiration from, them to be good stories. So Tolkien did not consider himself to be writing an allegory. George R. R. Martin, I think, similarly would say that he's not writing an allegory. When people take things like the others are climate change or something like that, then George R. R. Martin, as he's been asked this several times, he says, that's not my intention. I can see now that when having written this thus far, people see that there's lots of parallels that can be drawn. By all means, take that as a parallel. But I am not writing it as an allegory of climate change or anything else. So I think the short answer to that is no. Lawn Duck 20. Carl Carsonark, thank you very much. You've come out with some quotes. These are quotes from Tolkien, I'm assuming, saying, I cordially dislike allegory in all its manifestations and always have done so since I grew old and wary enough to detect its presence. Yeah, this is, I think, from the introduction that I was talking about. I much prefer history, true or feigned, with its varied applicability to the thought and experience of readers. I think that many confuse applicability with allegory. But one resides in the freedom of the reader and the other in the purposed domination of the author. Yeah, that's Tolkien's take on allegory versus applicability. Lawn Duck 20. Hello, Robert. Do you have any idea where the Mormonts lived before Bear Island? I don't believe it is ever mentioned in any of the books. Also, if you have time, why do you think the Northern clans accepted the Starks as their rulers, but the Vale clansmen won't accept the Arryns? Okay, I'll come on to that in a moment. In terms of Bear Island and the Mormonts, though they weren't always there. Bear Island was given to the Mormonts by the Starks. So it is a legend. The legend is that I think it was a Brandon Stark. It might not have been, whichever Stark was the king at the time, wrestled one of the Ironborn, and the winner took the Bear Island, and the Starks won it, and they gave it to House Mormont. So where House Mormont came from before that, as you say, we do not know. But the clear implication is that they were probably in the north, and someone that the Starks, again, this is reminiscent of what happened with the Manderleys, was they put the house, they gave the house that did not have a home, and said, you can have this if you're going to be loyal to us. And so that is what happened, was that the Starks gave it to this house or proto house. And it's noticeable that the houses most loyal to the Starks are the Mormonts and the Manderleys. And that is because the Starks specifically gave them their land, rather than some others who already had their land, but then the Starks attacked them and said, well, you can keep it as long as you recognize us as your lords. So that seems to be a big difference between a lot of the different the attitudes that a lot of the different northern lords have towards the Starks. Your second question was about why the northern clans accepted the Starks, but the Vale clansmen won't accept the Arryns. You say, do you think it's a difference in religion, or that they are the first men and the people in the Vale are Andals, or something else? I think you're quite right that it's partly that they are independent, and I suspect that the Starks were just better at doing what they do. But the Arryns, in terms of subjugating their peoples, basically. But the Arryns, yes, they were Andals, and they came across. So you get lots of petty kingdoms in the Vale, as we had in the north, but then you get this invasion from the Andals. It's a very slow invasion, and it came across, and they simply could not defeat the mountain clans. So my feel is that this wasn't the kind of warfare that they were used to at the time. The Knights of the Vale are well known, well regarded. They came across from Essos, this idea of knights and all the rest of it, and knights do not work well in mountains. On horses, wanting something to charge at, if you've got sheer mountainsides, lots of rocks and boulders everywhere, knights do not work very well. What works well is guerrilla warfare. So the type of soldiers that the Andals had, House Arryn had, did not work well with trying to subjugate the mountain clan. So I think they just gave up and came to this point. So they built these barriers. The Eyrie is incredibly defendable against normal attacks. So I think they just decided, you know what? We don't need them. There's no extra money there. There's no problem. As long as they're not bothering us, we've got the Vale. The Vale is exactly what it sounds like, a very lush valley. It's a lot smaller than the Reach, but it is probably about as lush as it, and it creates a huge amount of produce for them. And as long as that was safe, and as long as where they lived was safe, I think they just couldn't really be bothered. So I think that's what it was. Tronic, do you think George R. R. Martin might have missed an opportunity for Lady Stoneheart to learn that John is not Ned's son and try and make up for her cruelness? Since she is about vengeance, she might think that she needs to avenge the way Kat treated him. And she could have been the one to give him new life and pull him out of Ghost. She doesn't need to know the extent of his family lineage, just to know that Ned did him a solid by not letting the baby die. Yes, so I think I've had this from a few different people in different ways. I get the sense that a lot of people, they want Kat to come to terms with John in some way, because Kat was horrible to John and it wasn't his fault, but she couldn't take it out on Ned, so she took it out on John. There's no getting around it. I've, in my reread or re-listen to book one of Game of Thrones, I'm gaining a new appreciation for the character of Kat in some areas. She's clearly clever, she's got much more of a political brain than most people around her, but there's no getting around the fact that she was horrible to John. And I think that there is a feeling from quite a lot of people that it would be good for that to reach some resolution, for her to perhaps finally understand what's going on, what went on, to accept him for who he is. I think George R. R. Martin's not going to do that for us. It's my honest answer. Yes, I agree. It would be good. It would be nice. There are a few reasons for this. First of all, the Lady Stoneheart now is not Kat. A lot of what made Kat Kat has gone. What is left is this vengeful soul who is just very fixated on gaining revenge against the people who have wronged her family. That's her introspection of, oh, actually, you know what, I treated John badly, that I don't think is there at all. So that's one very good reason. The second one is that she's in the Riverlands, John is way up at the Wall, that's months away, there's a huge difference. She's got no motivation to be heading north that we've seen. It's certainly in the short term. So she is not going to be the person who can bring John back. It's just physically impossible. So I know I can feel people's desire for there to be some resolution on this, but I think it's, we have to start viewing this as tragedy that she never knew, and she could have had a good and strong relationship with John, but for Ned's not telling her, to be honest. And that, again, this is perhaps a flaw in Ned's character. Understandable, because when he first came back to Winterfell, he'd only known her for 2 weeks. He didn't know anything about her whatsoever. He had this secret that he had to keep from everybody. It's understandable that he didn't tell her, certainly to start with. And after that, I suspect PTSD took over and he didn't want to even engage his brain in it, and he just let it carry on. But I think that just adds to the tragedy of the whole situation. Mike S. McFly saying, hi, Indie Geek, I'm Tronic. I know she isn't going to do it. That's why I asked if you think he missed an opportunity, because she's too far away to help, among other things. Yeah, so absolutely sorry. I was going off on a slight tangent there. Yes, you're saying, did he miss an opportunity? He did miss an opportunity to do that, but I think it was deliberate. I think he enjoys tragedy. I think he enjoys suffering in terms of writing. And I think that that was a deliberate missing of an opportunity, not just him looking back and thinking, I should have done that. Eric Fugg, is Barbary Dustin actually still offended that Ned only brought back the horse, or is this a ruse to hide her contempt for the Boltons' phrase for the Red Wedding and the death of her nephew? Bringing back the horse over time could have actually been a touching gesture. Do you think her sister died naturally, or did Roose murder her? Okay, so Barbary Dustin, a few things here. Barbary Dustin is a complicated character, so I think that we shouldn't just have her down as being one thing or another thing. Do I think that she's still angry with Ned for not bringing back her husband's bones from the Tower of Joy? Because he didn't. He brought back Lyanna's bones, but not her husband's bones. Her husband had been one of the people who'd been there with Ned at the Tower of Joy. He instead just brought back the horse and said, well, here's the horse. But not only, we have to understand this, that not only did Ned not bring the bones back, but he then flatly refused, by implication, he flatly refused to say where they were, because she could have sent somebody down to go and collect them. He refused to say where they were. So he not only didn't proactively do it, and he could be forgiven for not bringing back the body, because frankly, it was in the middle of nowhere and it was just him and Howland. And yes, that would have been quite hard, but he could have got somebody to go and do it. He could have told them where the bodies were, and he didn't. Is she annoyed about that? Yes, I think she still is annoyed about that. She's also still very caught up emotionally in with Brandon. She was in love with Brandon. This is Ned's older brother. And then he was forced to, from her perspective, he was forced to break off their relationship in order to be marrying someone else. I think that these things are still true, because she talks to Theon, she goes down to the crypts. We see how she immediately alights on the statue. She wants to go to the statue of Brandon. She talks to Theon and swears him to silence. Why would she be talking to him at all? Because she knows that he's not going to be saying anything. She keeps on saying, you're not going to tell people any of this, are you? And he's no. So she's very clear about that. And I think everything from her mannerisms seem to suggest that this is the case. Added to all of that, incidentally, Barrowton, where she's based now, it's called Barrowton because it is built on a barrow in the middle of the Barrowlands. They take burying their dead very, very, very seriously. And for Ned to completely not bring the bones back or not give them the chance to bury their lord was a huge insult. So yes, that is still there. Is this a ruse to hide her contempt for the Boltons or Freys for the Red Wedding and the death of her nephew? Her nephew died at the Red Wedding. I think that it's not a ruse, But I think that she is hiding her contempt and hatred of the Boltons and the Freys, or at least many of them. And she is actively working against them. I think she is a part of this Grand Northern conspiracy. But that doesn't mean that she likes Ned Stark. She doesn't. So, as I say, she's a complicated character. We shouldn't just see her as being one side or another. And do you think that her sister died naturally, or did Roos murder her? So her sister was Roos Bolton's second wife, and she had a son, and both of them died in mysterious circumstances. Now, the clear implication is that her son was killed by Ramsay, because this was the person between him and legitimization, effectively. Her nephew was killed by Ramsay Bolton, and I think that again is enough for her to hate the Boltons. So I think what you've got is somebody who has got many, many layers of dislike and hatred of lots of different people at this moment in time. And yes, I think she is part of the Great Northern Conspiracy against the Boltons, but that doesn't mean that she's pro all of the Starks. She loved one of the Starks and she hated another one, and that I think is where we're at with Barbary Dustin. Kendra Summers, I said we'd come to your question in a bit, saying, I'm always fascinated how the infamous Lord Bloodraven can become Lord Commander of the Night's Watch and just disappear north of the Wall, and no one talks about it. You would think that having the legendary sorcerer, former Hand of the King, embarking on a suspicious expedition north of the Wall at ripe old age of 80 would turn into a story just as scandalous as those that plagued his life. The Stark children learn the history of the Targaryens. Jon pretends he's aiming the Dragon Knight, but where's the story about the mysterious disappearance of the Dragon Wizard? This is really interesting, because yes, and I think it should do. Now, I will give you an example of history of back in the 70s. Did you know that the Australian Prime Minister disappeared and died? these things get forgotten. At the time, it would have been huge news, I'm sure, but these things get forgotten. Similarly with Bloodraven, this was a mysterious end to a mysterious life. And frankly, it was a very long time in the past. So I can understand that this is perhaps not one of the great legends, because it's just a member of the Night's Watch goes north of the Wall and doesn't return. It's something that happens all the time. And so for the Starks, that they would not have seen that as anything particularly strange. People, if particularly, as you say, an 80-year-old man who's Lord Commander of the Night's Watch deciding to head north of the Wall, someone who, yes, he'd been at the Wall for quite a while, but still he wasn't like somebody who was a Stark or a Northerner, someone who lived and breathed the North, the fact that he disappeared and probably died is just a footnote in history as far as they're concerned. So yes, it makes an interesting story, but it's because we know the background to him. And the Starks, however, won't be as interested in the background to somebody who was Hand of the King, however fascinating. So I both understand it and think maybe some a bit more could have been made of it. I don't know. It's not that mysterious, is what I think I'm trying to say. Diego, actually, hang on. I just missed a question. It's there. Eric Fogg saying, what houses do you think the others will overrun and or extinguish? I think a lot of the North, definitely the last hearth is going to go. but the one to the north. I think that there is a good chance that the others may, I mean, I don't want to say it, but they may take Winterfell. They may move south of Winterfell and take some other places in the north. Winterfell has got huge amounts of defences, but the climactic battle, the climactic events could still happen on the Isle of Faces. Now, I don't know, maybe the events will happen on the Isle of Faces while a battle is raging at Winterfell. I'm not 100% sure on that, but certainly I felt from the show that after all those seasons of build-up for the White Walkers to, in the space of two episodes, to get to Winterfell and then that's it, felt a little bit anticlimactic, and I don't think this will feel anticlimactic. When the others reach the main bit of Westeros, south of the Wall, it is not going to feel anticlimactic. There's going to be a lot of places and people and dying, destruction. It's going to feel, it's not just like an army just nipping by the last hearth and then going to Winterfell and then losing. This is going to feel like the entire of Westeros is at risk of being overrun, and I think it will push very far south. What will they overrun? Almost everything in their way, or everything in their way, is the short answer. Diego Godoy saying, hola, hola, what do you think? Do you think Mance Rayder will survive the end of the story? What about Ghost and Summer? I think Mance will die, as I sort of hinted at earlier. I think that's the sort of the logical end of the Bale the Bard, Abel the Bard symbolism. I think that the logical end is that he will die in a way that he finds noble, having served his purpose within the story. You asked about Ghost and Summer. I think Ghost will definitely survive. I talked about Ghost last time and basically came up with the conclusion that he was going to... I think Ghost will be in the very final scene of the book. If you're interested in why I think that, do go back to last week's live stream. Summer, I could take either way with Summer. I don't think Summer has been important for Bran thus far, but I think Summer's importance once Bran has gained his training as a tree wizard is going to be greatly diminished. So I don't think there is a narrative need for Summer to survive. That doesn't mean that Summer will necessarily die, but George R. R. Martin does seem to like killing characters and direwolves, so I think there's a fair to even chance that Summer will die. Ghost, I think, will survive. Actually, this is my last question from my patrons, so now is the time to drop questions into the chat, and I will try and answer as many of them as I can. This is from Tronic, who is in the chat. So I know you covered it a while ago. I just wondered if you have any thoughts now about whether or not Rickon was supposed to be the one to take Bloodraven's spot and not Bran. I mean, Rickon is said to have a bigger role, according to George R. R. Martin. Do you think maybe we could find that, and someone or something has to get rid of him for Bran to somehow take his place in the Weirwoods, especially since Rickon is so young and kind of off the deep end as a human, but probably pretty normal as a feral animal? He is going full werewolf in London, don't you think? I think he probably will go very... feral is the word we all do seem to be using for him. So for those who have missed this theory, that there is a reasonable amount of evidence that Rickon is potentially a very powerful greenseer. Now, there are a few incidental things, like his Dire Shagadog's eyes are a greenseer colour. Also, when you get that scene when Bran goes down to the crypts because he thinks that you know, he's had a dream that his father is dead or there. Rickon is already there. He's had the same vision, it would appear, but he actually says father is here now. So he's just like, he actually senses it almost. So Rickon, the implication is that Rickon is potentially a powerful greenseer. Added to which, the when it's a slight nuance, but when Jojen and Mira head to Winterfell, they are there, they are sent there, effectively they've been sent there by Bloodraven via Howland Reed, to go and find this person that Bloodraven has been doing all the sort of the dream stuff with, the awakening, the magic and all the rest of it. And they go there with this image that Jojen has had of a chained wolf with wings. Now, so that is who Jojen is looking for. And this is the way that these green dreams work. You do not know what, basically you have an avatar in there and you do not know what you look like. So that, they are looking for who is it who is represented by this avatar, in the same way that Bloodraven is represented by a three-eyed crow, but does not know that that is what he is represented by. The Bran doesn't know what he's represented by in what other people see. So Jojen is looking for this chained wolf, winged wolf, and eventually decides that this is Bran, and so escorts Bran north. So that's all fair enough. But the if you just take it in kind of allegorical language, then the chains are preventing the winged wolf from flying. That's therefore going to be Bran, who's having the flying visions and all the rest of it. But actually, Rickon's wolf, Shaggy Dog, was the one being chained down, being locked up because it was so being so dangerous. So if you want to take a more literal interpretation, then actually Shaggy Dog is, and therefore Rickon by implication, is the stronger candidate for who he should be looking for. Rickon, of course, is very, very young at this point, so less chance than Bran to develop his powers. But the intriguing possibility, because we've not seen Bran at all since they set off for Skagos, The intriguing possibility is that he might have been developing his powers all through this time, and he might actually now be a stronger warg, but possibly a stronger greenseer. And that is something which is going to be fascinating to watch, to see when he does reappear, as I suspect he will. Does Rickon need to be got out of the way in order for Bran to take his place? I don't personally think that's true. I think that Bran was the person that Bloodraven was talking to through his dreams. And so Bran is the person who has to be brought up there, and was brought up there, and has shown that he has got the required powers. They fed him the weirwood paste. He could see through the weirwood trees. So Bran is the right person. Still means that Rickon could be incredibly powerful, and that we might see hints of it when he returns, which also, of course, adds to this idea of a Shaggy Dog story, because it's long and seems really convoluted and important, but ultimately leads to nothing. If he suddenly is actually incredibly powerful when he returns, that would just add to the complexity of Rickon's story, and also the tragedy when he is killed. Okay, let's have a quick check through the chat. P people just speculating about Rickon here. We need a series of books, says Johnny Skinwalker. Rickon, Wolf Prince of the North. That would be great fun. Carl Karsnark. I can't imagine George R. R. Martin will let Rickon go to waste as a Stark or a character overall. He may not live long, but I don't think he'll have a narrative dead end. The page space is too precious for that. I agree on that one. So I think that the important thing that George R. R. Martin says that Rickon is there for is that he is to be this figurehead for the retaking of Winterfell. He is the person who the North rallies behind. And I think if you try and get into the mind of George R. R. Martin, what would be the worst moment for him to die? It would be just after he has been this figurehead. They've retaken Winterfell. And then he dies and everyone's left looking around going, okay, so who's going to be in charge of the Starks now? Who's going to be Lord of Winterfell now? So that, I think, is probably the best or most George R. R. Martin-y time for his demise. It will have a meaning. Have a quick check through. Horizontal saying, after the war, if the others do not prevail, where will the Westeros version of the Treaty of Versailles be, and which parties would be excluded out of Westeros racism? Oh wow, that's quite a deep question. I think the center of all of this is that area. It's been the spiritual center of the story right from the beginning, is this few square miles where you've got Harrenhal, the Isle of Faces, the Inn at the Crossroads, the Ruby Ford. So much happens in that small area, and that is where all of this has to come to some sort of denouement, in my view. That is at the heartbeat of the story, and as a crossroads figuratively, where you can go, and that crossroads you could go west to Riverrun, east to the Vale, north to the North, or south to King's Landing, and is a place figuratively of choice. That I think is going to be a good place to be ending this, so people, where people choose, Harrenhal being right nearby, where people choose who their king is going to be. Kevin Pierce, I'm very grateful for your amazing channel and the hours I spent listening to your videos. Thank you. Will the great John return, in your opinion? Yes, I think he probably will. But whether he will be a broken man in some way. He's been a prisoner of the Boltons for a long time. He is going to be, he's not going to emerge well from this. And again, you have to get into the mind of George R. R. Martin. The Umbers hold him up, and everybody holds him up as this huge character, full of life, great. He's a leader, life and soul of the party. When he emerges, if he is not those things anymore, then that it's exactly the kind of tragedy that George R. R. Martin does a lot. Misty306 saying, hi all, I thought I'd miss this live stream. I'm afraid I'm starting to come to an end. You unfortunately have missed quite a lot. Indie Geek is Bronn from the North. I don't know. I think I'll probably end on this. This thought, actually, Bronn, I like the fact that Bronn is just a normal sellsword. Yes, he's a very talented sellsword. Yes, he's got a quick wit. Yes, he's quite a good social climber. He's got lots of skills. But there are so few characters, main characters in this, who are not a natural part of the nobility, or don't have some sort of hidden identity. I just want him to be exactly what he says, what he looks like. I don't want him to have a secret agenda. I just want him to be a sellsword. And I, for that reason, I don't really care where he comes from. And in fact, I think that the fact that he's sort of vaguely secretive about his past probably makes me want him to be just who he says he is even more. I've heard people suggest he might be some descendant of House Rain who is trying to get revengeance on the Lannisters, or I've heard people suggesting he might be all kinds of people in secret. I don't want him to be. I just want him to be a sellsword who just happened to be at the inn at the crossroads at that particular moment in time and made a life-changing choice at the inn at the crossroads to be following on with Tyrion and Kat. So on that note, what I think I will do is I will say that this was hopefully the start of a series working my way through the different regions of Westeros. I might move over to Essos later as well. We looked at the north, so next time I'll probably do either Riverlands or the Vale, perhaps. Chance to just focus in on the peoples, the places of Westeros moving across the piece. So if you've got any particular areas that you're particularly wanting me to be looking at, please do leave them down in the comments. But if you'd like to see more live streams like this and you are watching a little bit later, then somewhere around here will be appearing a link to them. If you would like to either support the channel or get access to some exclusive benefits, then there is a link to my Patreon page appearing somewhere around here. Okay, everyone, thank you so much. Particular thank you to my fantastic moderators today. And I will see you again this time next week. Take care, everyone. I'll also see you soon.